Good evening. I'd like to call this November 15th, 2022, 6 o'clock p.m. School Board Dinner and Work Session, followed by 7 o'clock p.m. regular meeting to order. And this evening, we have Mr. Reitinger. It has requested to participate remotely. He's got a work obligation, so I'd like to just ask for a vote that we could approve for Mr. Reitinger to participate remotely. All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Yes. All those opposed say no. Okay, thank you. Motion carries. So we will let Mr. Reitinger, we've approved for him to participate remotely given his work obligation. Okay, thank you. And we're now at 1.02. Ms. Goodell, could you please take the roll?
Yes, Dr. Dimmick?
Here.
Ms. Downs?
Here.
Dr. Gould?
Here.
Dr. Ortiz?
Here.
Ms. Silverman?
Here.
And Ms. Tice?
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you. If y'all could join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. We're now at 1.04. If I could have a motion, please, to adopt the agenda.
Chair, I move that the school board adopt the agenda as presented.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmick. May I have a second?
So moved.
Thank you, Dr. Ortiz. All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
All those opposed say no. Okay, thank you. The agenda is adopted. We're now at 2.01, school board's legislative priorities, and I will turn it over to Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, Chair Downs. Good evening, everybody, and thank you for coming in and being flexible with your time and enjoying some food with us. This evening, we have three items on the agenda for our work session. As you know, we are scheduled to be in regular session at 7, so if we can work as diligently as possible through this next hour, I think we should be able to get through our three items. Before I turn it over to Lilla Wise, our legislative liaison, I did want to let the board know that this week we did have a chance with Chair Downs and with Ms. Silverman and myself to have lunch with Senator Saslaw. Since November is Take Your Legislator to Work Month, we had a nice opportunity to visit with him yesterday. I think it was yesterday. The days are sort of running together, but yes, yesterday, to talk a little bit about your legislative agenda going forward and hear what some of the issues he thought were going to be at the session this time. So tonight, it's an opportunity to continue to hone in on your legislative priorities based on the feedback from the last conversation we had. Lilla took your comments away and did some more crafting. So I'll turn it over to, thank you.
Oh, thank you. Actually, the package looks very much like it did the last time you saw it, except we have two additions, and these are based on information that we've gotten from you. And the first one was understood that you wanted some sort of a legislative position on guns in schools. And so I tried to draft something that would indicate how much you care about this, and especially after yesterday on a school bus. I mean, you know, the fact that we have to do everything that we possibly can to keep guns out of the hands of not only children, of almost anybody. So I did come up with a position that values the safety of the students and staff at our schools and on our campuses, requests legislation that would strengthen the ability to keep guns out of the hands of children. And we give you some areas of legislation might involve who can get guns, what kind of weapons can be accessed, waiting periods, red flag laws, and storing of guns and ammunition. So if there was anything else that you wanted to see in there, I tried to encompass almost anything that we could think of. And it'll be interesting, especially after what happened at UVA in the last couple of days, to see whether there are people in General Assembly who have been so opposed to any limits on guns, and whether there may be some changes of heart. Let's hope. Then the other position is one that I've been working with Kristen on, and that is about your daycare program. And What we're asking is legislation to exempt from state licensure any daycare program staffed by local school division employees, attended by students who are at least 4 years of age, who are enrolled in the public school or preschool within the division, and is offered by a local school board at times other than during the instructional day. And I think we've covered all the bases here. And if you decide to approve this tonight, I will go ahead and talk to Delegate Marcus Simon's aide and his office and ask them to actually put in legislation for us on this. So other than that, there is nothing new and different other than what we had the last time we met.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ms. Watts. Any comments? Thank you so much. My only comment, and I guess this is for Dr. Noonan, Ms. Silverman and I and Dr. Noonan, we were talking with Senator Saslaw on Monday. He made it clear there was still not any appetite in Richmond. Gun control is such a partisan issue, and that there was still not, he didn't think there would ever be any movement on that. And I do think, to me, the one piece that our state doesn't have, that a lot of states have, is just a simple law about safe gun storage. And I know you have that in here. Mm-hmm. I don't know, Dr. Noonan, if you think it would be, knowing that some of this would never, is never, sadly is not gonna, but maybe that would be, I'm wondering if we focus just on that piece, maybe that would be something that we could get done, safe storage of guns. I don't know what you think about that.
It's a good idea, maybe, to think about narrowing the scope of it as opposed to making it a wide blanket statement about guns. And maybe what we could do is leave the top portion as the preamble, but then add a very specific position below underneath one of the section headings that says, we would like to have legislation that, I don't know exactly how to say it, but essentially would say that requires all gun owners to maintain safe storage, ensure that children under the age of 18 don't have access stored weapons or ammunition.
And not only to protect schools, but also to protect children, because that's the number one leading cause of suicide among teens is unsecured firearms. So that was just my thought, is maybe, I just think some of this is, we have so far to go to getting any of this done, but maybe that would be one that maybe we could make some progress on. So
under issues, we could add a very specific position, and maybe I could help you craft that, Bella.
Well, we've got storing of guns and ammunition in there. We can just add safe to it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now, what was Senator Saslaw, would he be willing to put legislation in on this? I don't imagine he would, but maybe you were able to convince him that this is something that...
Well, my understanding, Ms. Silverman or Dr. Nguyen can correct me. I mean, I think he is all for this, but he thinks that it's just such a partisan issue that it's never going to go anywhere, so...
And it would have to come out of the Senate originally. And Delegate Simon, as much as he would like to help us with this, especially in the House of Delegates, they have they only can put in a certain number of bills. Sometimes we've had years where, everybody, in fact, 2 or 3 years ago, there were some legislators in the House who had 51 bills. But now it's 11, or maybe it's 15. Don't remember quite which they did, and so we're not able to get people to put in legislation like we used to.
I would guess that he could help us on if we're just sort of attacking the safe gun storage piece of it. I think he would probably be able to lend us a hand. Do you think, Dr. Noonan?
I do. I think he'd at least be open to the concept.
Yeah.
What would also be sort of an interesting add-on to that would be if he was not completely comfortable, we will have a new senator in the next year who is going to be Chap Peterson. And I wonder if Chap would do that on behalf of Falls Church as a gesture of goodwill coming in as the new senator.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, I will talk to Senator Saslaw's office and see if he would be willing to do anything with that this year, and I'll let you know what he says.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you. Any other comments from everyone? Yes, Ms. Silverman.
One thing that we discussed last time, I don't see it in here. Maybe I'm missing it. I know that in the introduction, we were going to put something about supporting teachers and the ability to teach accurate history and, show us a sign of support for our teachers and staff and being able to do their jobs the way that they've been doing them. Are we still thinking about that, considering that? Did we not want to add that?
I don't know that I have a way to get around that, but I do think, I think one of the beauties of the City of Falls Church is we write our own curriculum. We take the curriculum standards and we can write our own curricula within those standards. So what I'm seeing and hearing is that some of these new standards are questionable, and we right now don't teach all of the standards, because if you think about, for example, whether a curriculum is viable, you know, even if you laid the standards of seventh grade social studies side by side, in order for it to be a viable curriculum, it means that you have to be able to get through the entire set of standards in a school year. And if we were to teach all of those standards with fidelity, it would take us about 18 months to get through all of those standards. So there's a number of things that we do. We de-emphasize standards. We eliminate standards. We take pieces of standards and leverage them in other places. So I think it's not a way around, but I think one of the things that we could do in the future, should those standards be adopted, and we don't know that they're going to be adopted, and there will be a point of time where the state board will take input about them, and then once and if they are implemented, there are certain sections of those standards we could certainly de-emphasize or not teach at all, and maintain our curriculum integrity around how we want to teach history and social studies. Because at the end of the day, and I think this is something that we could bolster in the introduction, perhaps, would be us to say, you know, the City of Falls Church School Board represents the community of Falls Church, and as such, we'll make curriculum and instruction choices to meet the needs of our local community. So that's one thing we could add in the introduction to sort of get at, I think, what you're asking.
So, because I think what you're saying is it's not quite ripe in order to add something in the legislative package if they haven't passed anything yet. There's nothing to say when there's nothing there. So I think that's a great idea, just to put something in the introduction to show that we are going to support this local control, which everybody supports in education, this local control of teaching the curriculum that we think is best for our community.
Right. I think we should do that. And the irony, I don't have to share the irony with you, but I just do find it extremely ironic that in this administration, they're looking for broader control and taking away local control and creating sort of bigger government when they've always fought for smaller government. So just an interesting juxtaposition. Sure. I'll send you a statement.
I
I didn't have a chance to hear him speak, and I haven't heard from my colleagues about that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Where do I need? I should go all the way back to telling you about Alan Siebert.
we'll have it in the minutes, yeah. But thank you, Ms. Weiss. So I think, can we leave it that you'll follow up? And I'm happy to help, but I think the two pieces were the sort of, for lack of a better term, academic freedom, for lack of a better term, yeah. And then also the safe gun storage.
Right. And you'll talk with Senator Saslaw, and then we'll work on some language.
Sure. The other thing that I think is interesting, the first thing that you have in here is supporting your students and the whole issue of discrimination due to gender and expression. But when the previous governor came out with their model policy and said all school divisions had to do this, that hasn't happened. There are lots of school divisions that chose not to do that. And one of the things I'm hearing from my colleagues is that their school divisions are saying, okay, you know, they can put out there all they want. We are going to treat our kids the way they should be treated. And so, you know, there don't seem to be any penalties any place yet for doing the right thing in this.
Thank you. Yes, Dr. Ortiz.
pardon me. I think I'd propose that it's at the beginning of page 3 on the swatting thing, you know, the notion of false emergency calls, false alarms. I know that those things can be a nuisance and can get in the way, but I think somewhat they dilute from the educational priorities that are in here, and it isn't as if there aren't, you know, laws against such things already. I don't know if that should necessarily be a priority that we put forward personally. Well, you know, I think that we have a lot, there's a lot of items here that I think merit like real consideration and would end up benefiting our students significantly. You know, this is a punitive thing. As much as I would like to see more action there, it's not something that I would consider a serious priority.
Okay. How does the rest of the board feel?
Yeah, and Dr. Nguyen, what are your thoughts from an operational perspective? And
I think I'd like to hear from the board.
Okay. Would anyone have any thoughts on that? So we're talking about, I guess, the first two paragraphs of page 3 are sort of similar.
Uh-huh,
one talks of swatting and one talks of false 911.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, I would support, but I also feel like from Falls Church City, I don't know if we've had, it doesn't seem like we've had this problem. So to me, it was a little bit out of left field, but I don't know.
As another example, I mean, like suppose you actually had a student who was maliciously doing such things. I wouldn't want to get in a situation where we supported legislation that like supported that student being tried as an adult for such matters or something like that. You know, I wouldn't want to start going down that road. I just, you know, this is not, you know, fundamental key legislative things that are really going to help us improve the state of the schools for our students. So I just don't think it's something that we need to have as a priority here.
One of the reasons that both of these came up about was these were things that were happening in schools. So it wasn't, you know, just something that isn't within the school. But I certainly understand what you say. I think we're going, regardless of how we feel about it, I think there is definitely going to be some legislation on this, and whether or not it's going to go through. And it's been developed with police departments too, so you've got, you know, criminal justice and a whole bunch of other people, but I certainly understand what you say is that's really not our major role.
And knock on wood, we haven't had an issue with that, and I think I said that in the last meeting as well, with swatting or you know, hoax communications to 911. We've had one very critical lockdown that was an accidental lockdown, but otherwise we haven't experienced anything that would require action on our part. So I wouldn't be opposed to taking it out. I guess that's my point.
Would the rest of the board feel okay with removing those two paragraphs?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, let's go ahead and
take them out. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Weiss. And any other comments before? I know we're on a tight timeline with this meeting.
I know.
All right, well, thank you so much, Ms. Weiss. And I think we'll do one more round of additions and some edits, and then I think we'll be
good. Okay, and let me know as soon as you, because I do want to get in touch with, because the daycare one is really a Falls Church issue. It's not something you're going to see anyplace else. And it's one that really needs to be taken care of, and we need to get it, you know, to Delegate Simon as soon as possible.
May I ask for the consensus of the board to move forward with that one with mm-hmm. Delegate Simon? Because I do think it is, the sooner we can get it to him, the better.
Yes, that's everyone good with
okay.
that?
Yeah, because I can call his office and get them working on it right away.
That'd be great.
So you have our backing on that, so please.
Okay, I'll do it.
That.
Yep.
Okay, thank you so much, Ms. Wise. We really appreciate you being here on a rainy, gross night. So
horrible.
Thank you again.
And I look forward to seeing you all at the legislative breakfast, whether you're going to be there
in person.
We found over the past 2 or 3 years that when we were doing it remotely, we had a lot more legislators who were involved in it. So that's why we're doing this hybrid thing this year, and we'll see how that works. Yeah. So look forward to seeing you all then.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay, we'll move on now to 2.02, School Board's FY 2024 Budget Priorities. And do you want me to go straight to?
Let me kick us off.
Yeah.
And then I'll ask Kristen to chime in as well. Thanks again. This is the time of year where we are certainly in budget season in earnest. And every year we come to you and start to ask you what some of your priorities budget-wise are as we move forward. Tonight's not the night to come up with a comprehensive list. It's more of an opportunity to sort of get you thinking a little bit about where your priorities lie. But one of the things that I wanted to share with you is kind of where we are from an operational and instructional side of the house with respect to the budget process to date, and kind of give you some sense of what we've been thinking about and see where you are and test that against sort of what your ideas might be. So we have now at this point sent out the budget request forms to all of our schools. The school leaders have met with their staff, have gone through meetings, at least that's what they've reported to us, and we are fairly confident that that happened. And we now have a number of requests from each of the schools and each of the departments requesting certain things. And they request things from human resources to instructional resources to other kinds of assets. At this point, we have north of $1 million of new requests from our schools. And so we know that that's going to all be in play. Last year, you may remember, at the end of our budget cycle, we were very fortunate and able to fund just about everything that our schools had asked for. It was the first time that that has happened since I've been here, and as a consequence, everybody was very happy. But as we think about this year going forward, and knowing that we have that sort of roughly north of $1 million in some requests from our schools, and we also know that we want to do some sort of employee compensation, and that has always been a high priority for us to do a cost of living adjustment, but also at minimum a step increase. So we, you know, as you know, we're on a step and grade system here, and our teachers and staff expect a step in addition to a cost of living adjustment. And then on top of that, there are some other costs that we have started to think about and sort of kick around as part of our planning processes for the coming year. One is we have some fixed costs. For example, our health insurance, we're fixed in additional costs there. We don't know what the growth is gonna be, but we always bake in about a 10% healthcare addition. We have, because of some inflationary aspects of what's going on, there are some of our other fixed costs that are going up, for example, fuel and materials and supplies. But also we are looking at some additional things that we've talked about here. One example is family leave. We have costed that out and have a line item in our budget that we're hoping to present to you when we come forward with the superintendent's proposed budget to have that family leave in there. We also are changing the payout for sick leave. which will be a cost, and we're also looking at continuing to build the capacity of our staff. So looking at additional costs associated with training and professional development. So those are some things that we are looking at. But if I were asked today to put a priority personally on kind of where I was thinking we would need to go, one of the things that the one thing that I would land on is always compensation for our staff. I've said it before and I'll say it again, you know, we are the best school system in Virginia by every metric. And as a consequence of that, I think our staff deserve to be paid the highest in the state. And so we're on our way towards that. So certainly doing doing a step and some sort of cost of living adjustment, I think would be a really high priority for us. And then once we were able to do that, begin to work down that list of other things. That said, when you put all of that together, we are looking at somewhere in the neighborhood of an 8-9% increase if we were to fund everything again, like we did last year. And the economics in the city are really strong and good. And because of our revenue sharing agreement, we will get a portion of what comes into the city coffers. But I don't know what that percentage is. But I did want to let you know, going into our meeting, our joint meeting in December with the city council, that when we start putting some of these numbers into our spreadsheets, we are looking at numbers north of 8%, closer to 9% need to get everything that we want anyway. And let me say want as opposed to need. So Kristen, do you want to add to that?
The only other thing is the compensation side. Right.
Yeah. So one other placeholder that we do have in our budget that we're looking at as a placeholder for the compensation study. We had our kickoff meeting yesterday with Siegel, who is the company that we contracted with to do the work. We're very excited about having a couple of meetings even before the holidays to get the ball rolling. We think that we should have some pretty good information even as early as late March. I know that sounds late in the budget process, but being able to put a placeholder into the budget now, we feel like we'll be able to cover, we hope we'll be able to cover what comes from that compensation study. We asked for guidance from Siegel on what a good number would be in the budget, and they suggested holding a placeholder of about 4% of the overall salary file in the system. So that's that would be on top of the cost of living adjustment and on top of the step as well. Did I cover it all? I think I might have covered it all. Oh, all right. So we would love to hear from you. Sort of how does that match or not match some of the ideas that you have or you've been thinking about, and sort of turn it back to you. Chair Nance.
Anyone have any questions or comments? Dr. Dimmick?
Thank you very much, Dr. Noon. I am happy to hear that we're factoring in something for the compensation study. I think it's, if we want to lead in the state on compensation, then we can't have sort of inequity in how our folks are paid compared to neighboring districts. I guess I'm under the impression that there might be a large discrepancies with our administrators. So as long as you think we have enough in there to, you know, keep the good people that we have, that would be great.
We've had a chance to look at some data already. And just by the way, the compensation study is going to compare us to six districts, actually, that are the districts that typically we would lose people to. So it's Arlington, Alexandria, Fairfax, Prince William, Loudoun, and that's it, five. So we will be looking at those. We have looked at some data that indicates there's some discrepancy already among all five. Some areas were higher, some areas were lower, but the idea is to try to get into a range. Our staff currently is compensated for their stage in their careers are pretty close to what they would be making elsewhere, but our salary scale itself may be lagging, so we want to make sure that we bring them to where they need to be.
Sure.
I'm not going to phrase this well. So we've been fortunate to be able to give our staff bonuses, which are great and very welcomed, and they're sort of at a fixed amount, so it's, you know, really beneficial to our staff who are on a like a lower salary scale. But I guess I'm not. I would really much rather see us be able to take account of that money in our budgeting process, rather than sort of give our raises through bonuses that we can't necessarily replicate or it just seems we've been doing a lot lately, and it would be really nice to use our, I guess, be able to plan forward, you know, like if we just give people bonuses, that's wonderful for them, but what then happens when we, you know, don't have extra money for a bonus and we haven't raised pay as we should. And I know you're working on this, excuse me, with our city council partners, but I am concerned that I'd like to see that money in the budget sort of in the new year going forward, rather than, oh, surprise, right, Here's this money and, you know, or, yeah.
We don't disagree with you. We would love to be able to put that into the budget. Those monies are one-time monies that come to us. So they're money that it's year-end balance, or we've received quite a bit of money through the ARPA fund. And because that is not recurring money, we can't actually put it into the budget. So rather than sit on it and hold it, we want to give it to our employees, which is what it's meant for. But if we were to take, say, $1 million that we had in ARPA one-time money and put it into a recurring budget, once it's run out, we would have to cut it. So even if we put $1 million, excuse me, into the salary funds and created a new salary scale, for example, once that $1 million was gone, we'd have to revert back to our old salary scale because it's one-time money. That's the challenge of it. And you know, the surprise of it for our staff, it's a surprise of it for us as well, because we don't realize it's necessarily coming. And the state put in some additional funding specifically for staff bonuses. So the way that it comes to us sometimes, where our hands are tied in just the ways that we can spend it. But I guess the point of that is that we agree with you, but when we have these limited funds that are one time, our choices are to either give a bonus or to not give a bonus and just have the money in the bank.
And if I may add, the recommendation to City Council to provide the same bonus to their staff was presented to City Council last night.
So just to circle back on the salary say, so that will include school-based principals and assistant principals?
Yes.
Okay, great. Yes, Ms. Silverman.
And at the other end, it includes staff as well, non-teaching staff? Okay.
We were able to identify 26 positions as part of this study, and Siegel's going to come do a presentation for you in the December meeting to talk about the scope of work that they're doing. But the 26 positions are very strategic in that once we know what those 26 positions are, we can leverage off of those for other positions that weren't necessarily included. We could have included every position in the system, but for every additional position after 25, we'd have to pay $1,000 per position. And we have a ton of different positions in the system. So what we did was very strategically looked at if, you know, for example, if we had one 10-month teacher and one 11-month teacher, we didn't need to do the 11-month teacher. We could just do the 10-month teacher and then understand what that is and then leverage off that to understand what the 11-month teacher would be. So there's 26 positions that have been identified.
So within the teaching positions, do we go along the whole career path, you know, beginning teacher without an advanced degree all the way up to somebody who's been here 25 years with the advanced degree and everything in between?
They look at our salary scales. They look at everything.
Okay. Secondly, you said March. How much time is left after March before budget?
Oh, you won't adopt your final budget till May.
May. Okay, so that's 2 months. And then you said there's a placeholder of 4%. 4% of what?
4% of the entire human resources account.
So of our appropriated budget from City Council, 4% of that goes strictly to salaries.
It would be 4% of our entire salary base. So one way to think about it is it would be equivalent to the cost of a 4% COLA.
Okay.
So we get funds from multiple places, including the state and localities. So if you look at our
our salary file, for example, it's comprised of more than just the transfer from the city. It also includes money from the state. It also includes money from the federal government. So it's 4% of that salary file. So as Kristen indicated, it's like doing a 4% cost of living adjustment, and each 1% is in the neighborhood of $400,000. So we're looking at about a $1.6 million placeholder for the salary study.
Okay, and putting into the dollar terms, yep, helps me. Did he base that 4% on any knowledge, or was that just something that he kind of recommends to everybody?
He's done these salary studies. Part of the reason that we selected Siegel as a company is that this company has done these salary studies in Northern Virginia for many years. And so it's based on their experience of how out of bounds or the current salary scale might be. And it's about an average of 4%.
So it's not really based on Falls Church City specifically. It's more guideline of what he's come to know across this region.
That's right. So it could be plus or minus 2%, 1%, I don't know.
Which is $400,000 each way.
Of course.
Way.
Yeah. Right. But we're small.
And can I also add, in addition to Siegel doing the salary study for our base salaries, as part of the strategic plan, we were also reviewing all the EPEDs, extra pay for extra duty supplements that we pay for as well. And that work is ongoing, and we expect that to come in the budget as a recommendation as well. So we've had a team of very dedicated school leaders and staff working on that, so that'll be incorporated.
That's excellent. And that's in the same line item here, or is that a different line item?
That's actually different. This is just for the salary study.
Great.
For Siegel.
That's great to hear. Thank you.
Yes, Ms. Tice.
I just wanted to say I'm so thrilled that to hear about the family leave, and I know I've heard from several staff who are excited about it too, and I'm sure you have not noodled through every last number here, but I just wanted to, the number was surprisingly low, your original estimate that you shared over the summer, which was great. I mean, but I'm curious if you factored in the additional amount of men that might be able to take advantage of it too. I mean, if you use just the number of people who've taken it, I would predict that not very many men have taken it in the past when it's unpaid.
And I think you're right. Part of it is we don't necessarily know how many men didn't take advantage of it in the past.
Right. Yeah, of course. So I was just going to mention, I think you're just to keep that in mind. I know it's an impossible estimate. And then also something that had come up sort of over the summer. I know we can't always, it wouldn't make sense and it wouldn't be possible to always have parity with city employees on every benefit, but I think something like this would go along, it would make sense to have a similar package or the same package. I also think, if the money is all coming initially from the same pot, that might be more palatable to everybody. And currently I know the city's program is 12 weeks FMLA and 6 weeks paid, which might be a reasonable floor to start at. It's certainly not, I would advocate for as high as we could go, but I do think that's something to consider, and I know it's something I've talked to our other our colleagues on city council about. It seems to make sense that this is an opportunity for us to work together on that one. Maybe you've already
thought
about
it. For transparency, that's what the estimate was based on, was a 6 week additional.
And I know that they're also struggling. They're looking at compensation and where their employees have been frozen over the last several years. So I know they're doing a lot of similar work. It's obviously impossible for us to have a sense of what market rate would be for teachers, since no teachers anywhere or no school staff anywhere get paid parental leave or family leave. But they do. So it would be interesting to see what they find out as they're researching and how their policy, relates to other, because they have obviously a lot more to compare to than we do. So it'd be interesting to see where we end on that.
Echoing Ms. Tice's comments about the parental leave, it's exciting to know that we are hopefully going to be leading and showing all school districts in the state and the region that this is something that we should be valuing. I know that the reasoning why we haven't had it in the past is because it's not something of benefit for school districts. So to Dr. Noonan's point about our district being number one, this is an incredible benefit. So I'm really excited that we're going to be getting there. Especially given the public comments about how teachers have had to take leave in the past and how complicated it can be. The other priority I'd really like to push on, I think it was a public comment that was made by a Falls Church City resident that's a substitute and has served as para, Carol Ann Siciliano, a couple meetings back. about pay for paras and for subs. And I know compensation is obviously a broad, an important and top priority given that we've got good staff. It would be excellent if we can really focus in on how to make sure we're not just increasing pay for hourly employees as well, because I think there is a difference, at least in some of the numbers that I've seen. Our teachers are paid pretty significantly competitively, but there might be a difference in our paras and our subs. And so if we just increase by percentage, we're not doing any kind of catch up, or they are going to be served. And I think the role of the para, the role of the sub, the role of the hourly support is critical for our backbone. And I would imagine that that cost is not as great in terms of an impact as some of our W-2 staff. So it'd be great if we can do some kind of catch up or focus on that, or at least look at that.
We certainly can look at it. We won't find a comparison for parasub in any of the five school divisions that we've outlined, because we're the only school division that does substitutes for paraprofessionals. So the fact that we even have paras is unusual. Is unusual, but we certainly can look at the substitute compensation just generally.
Yeah, I meant, I'm sorry, substitutes and paras,
and
para. Substitute paras.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Just those two roles.
So I think her comments were specifically as a substitute para.
So we can
look at it.
I think she said both. She served as both. Mm-hmm. And then she focused in on the para. Yeah, I could be wrong.
No,
either
no,
way,
it's
both roles.
Yeah, we'll look at them. We'll look at them both. Yeah, definitely, for sure.
So it just Carol Ann's comment was about being a substitute teacher versus a substitute paraprofessional.
Correct.
And
yeah.
She was making the point that she felt it was a much harder job to be a substitute paraprofessional, but you were compensated at a lower rate than a substitute teacher.
Yep. So in the interest of time, we still have to talk about the calendars and we have to close out in 15 minutes. So how about, if it's okay with everyone, if you have any other budget comments, you can email Dr. Noonan and Ms. Michael and copy Vice Chair Gould and myself. Would that be okay with everyone? Because I know that the next one was a hot topic, so I don't want to make sure we have enough time to talk about that.
Thank you.
Okay.
And tonight was just sort of a
yes,
whetting
no,
your
thank
appetite
you.
Anyway. So.
Well, you can tell we're ready.
I know. You look hungry.
So we're going to move on now to 2.03, recommendation of school calendars. I'll turn it back over to you, Dr. Noonan.
Thank you. And I'm going to ask Mr. Bates and Ms. Michael to go through it or in a minute. But as I have been going to a number of meetings today specifically, we met with SEEK this morning at 7:30. I met with SAOs at 10 o'clock this morning, and then we met with PEAK after school today, and have had a chance at each of those three meetings to talk about the calendar. And barring the continued feedback regarding the loss of the four holidays, the feedback has been really positive about the calendars that have been put out. So I want to thank Kristen and William and the team for really putting these together and thinking them through. There's a couple of things that I want to call your attention to make sure, and I don't want to steal your thunder, Kristen, so I'll let you take some of it here in just a second, but particularly I want to call your attention to when we start and when we end. This will be a short summer. I think everybody knows that going in at this point, and we will be back to the longer summer the following year. But our new teachers would return on August 7th, and the first teacher work day for all staff would be on August 9th, and it would be the 9th, 10th, and 11th. Currently, we have no plan to do anything differently than we have in the past several years to allow our teachers to flex those days. We will call them teacher work days because they are teacher work days, but we're allowing our principals to have some flexibility with how those days look. So staff who are our teachers specifically may or may not be on campus on those days, so long as they've met their obligations of getting their classrooms set up, making sure that they've done their safe schools training, some other things. And then we have everyone back on the 14th of August. Right now we are looking at doing convocation on that day, 14th. We did get a little bit of feedback at the SAO meeting about concerns regarding doing it on the 14th, specifically from food services, because developing a menu and getting all the food ready for everybody to do that 14th has been hard, and that's why it was moved to Tuesdays several years ago. But we have a lot of pressure from the schools to do it on a Monday, so we're going to work through those as best we can. In these calendars, you'll see that there is a two-week winter break. And I got a couple of questions about the winter break, and let me I'll leave those for Kristen to address. There are all the federal holidays. There's 3 months at Thanksgiving, or 3 weeks, 3 months. It's the best schedule ever. 3 days at Thanksgiving and a full spring break. You'll note specifically that we end school on for kids on June 7th next year, and it's June 6th the following year. So one thing that we wanted to make sure of is if we start earlier, that we actually get out earlier, and this will be an earlier release than we've ever had. One thing that's sort of a new twist to the calendar that I want to give you some feedback about that I've heard from the community, and it's all been super positive, is making the Tuesday after Memorial Day a teacher work day and holding graduation on that day. There's a couple of things. One is families are coming together. It's easier to have a big family holiday together that's followed up with a last day of graduation. We've heard from our parents saying that, you know, they love it because now their younger kids can come to their older siblings' graduation much easier than they had in the past. Our teachers have said it'll be great. I'll be able to go on the teacher work day and attend graduation and see students that I may not have otherwise been able to see graduate. But the feedback around that has been really positive, and people have been very happy about that shift. So with that, I'll stop and let Kristen, Michael sort of talk about some of the other things, but then answer any questions you may have. And anything we don't get to tonight, Chair Downs, we certainly will take electronically and give you written feedback about the calendars as well.
In each of these calendars, we do have every federal holiday as being a holiday for all staff. So none of them were used for a teacher work day or other component. They're all holidays. When we look at the two-week winter break, in this first calendar, winter break would start on Monday the 18th. The question that we received is, could the break start potentially midweek or run later? And when we looked at the calendars for all of the surrounding jurisdictions, this current school year, Christmas is just one day earlier, and all of the school divisions did their two-week winter break the last 2 weeks in December, and then with the exception of us, they all extended and had their New Year's holiday on January 2nd. So they actually had an 11-day holiday. So historically, it appears that we've always leaned towards having the break earlier before Christmas as compared to later. Typically, we have not seen any midweek breaks starting in the middle for school divisions. And I think in general, because it's very challenging in terms of staff and families deciding to take the whole week and either missing the school before the break or after the break. And then lastly, Alexandria City has already adopted their calendar for the 23-24 year, and they have selected the same winter break that we've shown on our calendar from December 18th through January 1st.
Thank you, Ms. Michael and Dr. Noonan. Any questions? I know you all have questions or comments. Yes, Dr. Ortiz.
Yeah, a couple. Dr. Noonan or Ms. Michael, could you share kind of the rationale around, I have two questions, I'll just ask the first one, around where you place the teacher work days, just so that we have a good understanding of, you know, obviously you put thought into it and it's intentional, so if you could let us know what that is, that'd be helpful.
I would be happy to. We've really listened to our teachers in terms of where the teacher work days go. They've been very clear that they need a teacher work day at the end of each quarter for grading. So you'll see at the end of the first quarter, there are 2 days for grading. That is so teachers can finish their grading and we can have conferences. And it's very critical to have conferences at the end of the first quarter. So those are the teacher work days on October 26th and 27th. Then at the end of the first semester or the second quarter, which ends on January 19th, that is followed by a teacher work day on January 22nd. The third quarter ends on March 22nd, which is the Friday prior to spring break. So the teacher work day for grading there falls on Monday the 1st. And then we always have a teacher work day after the last day of school, again, to let teachers finish all of their grading for the fourth quarter. Again, in this calendar, we have the teacher work day for graduation, as Dr. Noonan indicated, allowing teachers to participate in graduation. And then we also worked very closely with our school leaders and our teachers in terms of planning the teacher work days and the professional development day schedule in that week, the 1 week pre-school starting.
Okay, very good. Thank you so much, Ms. Michael. And then the other question is just, I think, to point it out, in the proposed 2024 calendar, the Easter week falls directly after the end of the third quarter, right? So that is kind of like aligned actually with the way the policy is written. And then just flipping ahead to the 24-25 calendar, the end of the, I will get better at reading these one of these years.
Yeah.
The end of the quarter is the 27th of March. So if we were to follow the policy rather than the convention of the neighboring districts, then that week beginning March 31st would likely be the date that the week that we would have spring break. Is that correct?
Absolutely correct.
Okay, very good. Thanks.
The only in semantics, I would suggest that we are following the policy by having it where it is. The only difference is there's some flexibility in the policy.
Yeah, indeed. I don't want to belabor those points. I just wanted to make sure
gotcha.
That was clear.
Thank you.
Yes, Ms. Silverman.
So I was the one that had questions about the winter break. If you can go, I guess we can start with this one. That's fine. December 2024, it starts on the 23rd, and so that first week of January is off. But when you go into the next year, it's that earlier week. It's that, the 18th, and then that extra day on January 1st we would take off as a federal holiday. And I know that you said Alexandria has already adopted, and I'm not pushing for one way or another. I'm looking more for, is this typically how school districts do it? That if you're getting out on the 22nd, you do it the week before. But if you're getting out on the 20th, but you can get out on the 21st, which is what would happen the following year. Or I guess it's a leap year, so it would happen.
It just really depends on how it lines up with,
okay.
With the Christmas Day holiday, federal mm-hmm. holiday. And we don't ever want to end school on a Wednesday or a Thursday, midweek. We always want to end on a Friday.
I understand the midweek issue. I guess my question was just, are we sure that this is the best situation instead of getting out on the 22nd through the 5th?
Yes, and I appreciate that question. And that's where I did the research looking at what everyone did this year, where Christmas is just one day earlier than this calendar that's proposed for 23-24, where Christmas is falling on Sunday versus Monday, and all of the jurisdictions did this exact thing with the week prior to Christmas, and then that week that has Christmas with New Year's Day the following Monday being a holiday. So presumably, when I look back at history, that's what people have done, and that's the approach that everyone took this year, so I would really expect that to continue.
Yeah, I thank you for doing the research because I didn't. But if that's typically how it's done when Christmas falls on that Monday, then that's what we do.
Yeah, well, and I think the other issue is that, so using Fairfax, for example, so if we like went into December, 22nd or whatever, and Fairfax, or whatever that Wednesday is, and then Fairfax is out on that Monday, then you've got teachers with kids at home and they're coming to work. So I think that's hard on our staff.
Yeah, I'm just trying to find alignment here.
I'm just throwing that out there. I get it. Yes. That's true. Cool.
Some of the feedback we received on the removal of the religious holidays has been the skepticism of the resolution in terms of being enforced by teachers, staff, principals. I'm wondering if there's, at risk of adding another letter, I'm wondering if there's any way we could denote those four holidays that are specifically called in our policy on this calendar, just to remind folks. I know it is in the footnote. But I don't know if that would be enough to signal or remind people that those days should be respected by the resolution.
So we included on the second page of a calendar, a list calendar, where we tried to be really specific. So it's on page 2.
I see that, yeah.
Where we indicated, so for example, the first religious holiday is Rosh Hashanah, and we've included the guidance with the regulation specifically on here. In addition to this, after the board adopts a calendar, we plan for schools to do a one-page summary calendar of the religious days specifically to give them that as separate, very clear guidance in addition to the calendar.
Okay, so on the calendar specifically itself, which is, I know, what a lot of people will use, is it too much to put a different kind of letter because we have so many letters, or?
What if we didn't do a letter? Can you scroll back up, Mr. Brett? What if instead of doing a letter, we used a different shade of color. Mm-hmm. And then just at the bottom indicated to see regulation CC or
perfect.
Something.
That would, yeah, I think that would, this is what usually gets printed, I imagine, and put up, and that's that would be
is
great.
That okay?
That'd be great.
Is that okay with the rest of the board? Mm-hmm. Okay. And that leads to another question that came up from the board, and that is knowing now that we're going to do that and shade those four, Eid, Diwali, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, do we need to have all of the other days on there, like Lunar New Year, Good Friday, all of those? Should we just take those off and just show the four that... seeing some head nods.
Yeah, my thought is, I generally agree that I think the four holidays that are included in our policy, but specifically, like, I look at Easter, that's on a Sunday anyway. So, you know, I guess maybe where I would say maybe is if it's something that's on a weekend, I definitely don't think it needs to be on there. Mm-hmm. I don't know how others, yes, Ms. Tice.
I was going to agree. To me, it seems like the only thing that needs to be listed below are the federal holidays and the holidays that are acknowledged in our regulation. I mean, I don't see the need to put Easter on there if we're not putting Lunar New Year and Orthodox,
okay.
Good Friday, et cetera, et cetera. So that would be my preference.
I agree.
What if they're during the week? What if, for example, I'm sorry. So Good Friday, take that off. Okay. All right, so what I think I'm hearing, correct me because I'm maybe a little bit distracted, is we'll just do the 4 days that we've mentioned, shade them a different color, denote them, and take everything else off. Okay.
And I also think that lends, you know, I think this board would like to see, right, would like to see spring break not tied to Easter. So I think just pulling that off, you know, that it's not, you know, if it happens, you all know what I'm trying to say here. So I don't think we need to denote the holiday right there because that's not really why our goal is eventually to have it aligned with the third quarter. We need to wrap up. I know that one quick thing, I know that Ms. Tice had, and I thought this just might be a quick conversation. Election Day, I know we had this conversation many times, but presidential election day, so every 4 years. Do you feel comfortable, again, this is, in my perspective, this is different than a midterm election, so this would be the presidential election. Do you feel comfortable having school open, or every 4 years do we need to close?
I think we can open school.
Okay.
And here's the thing, is we have some flexibility at Oak Street too, and I don't want to say we're going to do it or not do it, but we could also perhaps use the where the library was relocated temporarily for voting. We had a library on campus and we had people coming through all the time. So I feel like we're masters of like managing and organizing large groups of people. So I think we'll be all right.
Okay. All right. So again, if you all have any other questions, so the idea here is that we would be voting on these next meeting. So I'm assuming you'll give us one more version of these based on our feedback tonight.
Correct.
Yes, Ms.
And
Michael.
The other piece of feedback I got that I'll make the changes, including Inauguration Day, which is a federal holiday on that calendar.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And then, again, feel free to, if there's anything else that you all think of, feel free to just email and copy Vice Chair Gould and I, because I'm sorry this, but I feel like we're, you know, that's the beauty of this calendar policy. Thank you, Mr. Reitinger, who I see is on Zoom with us. The beauty
not
of the calendar policy is that we don't have to reinvent the wheel every year. And so that's the whole goal, is that should be pretty easy. Yes.
Once you make those kind of minor changes, I'd request that the division post these for comment just so that everybody's got them ahead of time.
Yeah, we can run them in morning announcements a few times before we vote to get the... Would that be okay, Dr. Noonan?
Yeah, we can put
okay.
it in the morning.
When they're ready. When
I mean, they're
feel
always
like...
up for comment on the board site.
Yeah.
But we definitely can put them out and say that these are the calendars that the school board's going to vote on.
Okay. Thank you all. Okay.
Thanks.
And we're going to wrap this portion of the meeting up. Wait a second, Dr. Ortiz, we have to adjourn. Okay, so we're going to wrap this up, and then we're going to move right next door to start our regular meeting. So we are adjourned. Thank you very much. See you in 5 minutes. Okay, well, welcome back, everyone. We just came from our work session next door, and now we're going to be starting our regular meeting.
And so we're at 4.01. I'd like to call this November 15th, 2022 regular meeting to order. And let me see. Under policy BDD, electronic participation in meetings from remote locations, the chair reports requests for remote attendance to the board members who are assembled at the primary meeting location. And board members must vote on each member's request for approval. And Mr. Reitinger this evening is joining us remotely due to work obligations. So I'd just like I guess I'm looking for a vote to see if that we would approve his request to participate remotely. All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Yes. All those opposed say no. Okay, thank you. Sorry, Mr. Reitinger, you got to stay on now. Okay. We are now at, let me get back to the agenda. We're at 4.02, roll call. Ms. Goodell, could you please call the roll?
Yes, Dr. Dimmick?
Here.
Ms. Downs?
Here.
Dr. Gould?
Here.
Dr. Ortiz?
Here.
Mr. Reitinger?
Here.
Ms. Silverman?
Here.
And Ms. Tice?
Here.
Thank you.
Thank you. If you all could join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. I would now like, I'm seeking a motion to adopt the agenda.
I move to adopt the agenda as presented.
Thank you, Dr. Ortiz. May I have a second? Thank you, Ms. Silverman. All those in favor say yes.
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 All those opposed say no. Thank you. Motion carries. The agenda is adopted. And now we're at 5.01, Native American Alaska Native Heritage Month, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, Chair Downs. As I think the board knows, each month we're going to bring you some resolutions to read on behalf of our communities here in the City of Falls Church and Native American Alaska Native Heritage Month. And I'd like to thank the community member who advised us it's not Alaskan Native, it's Alaska Native Heritage Month. Thank you for that. Is coming up, and we'd like to celebrate that and celebrate our Native community.
Great. Thank you. I'll go ahead and read this resolution into the public record. Let me get. Okay. Whereas, and this is Falls Church City School Board Resolution 14-22, 2022 Native American Alaska Native Heritage Month. Whereas the month of November is recognized as Native American Alaska Native Heritage Month, and whereas Falls Church City Public Schools are committed to recognizing and celebrating the diverse cultures represented in our community, staff, and students. And whereas President George H.W. Bush first recognized Native American Alaska Native Heritage Month in November 1990, whereas this month is a time to learn about tribes, to raise a general awareness about the unique challenges Native people have faced both historically and in the present, and the ways in which tribal citizens have worked to conquer these challenges. And whereas there are 324 distinct federally recognized Native American reservations, including federal reservations and off-reservation trust land, and whereas there are 7.1 million Native American Alaska Native Heritage people in the United States as of 2020, and whereas there are currently over 142,000 Native American Alaska Native Heritage veterans of the U.S. Armed Forces. And now, therefore, be it resolved that the Falls Church City School Board does hereby proclaim November 2022 as Native American Alaska Native Heritage Month in Falls Church City Public Schools and urges all to respect and honor our diverse community and celebrate and build a culture of inclusivity and equity. So we are at 5.01. If I could have a motion to adopt this resolution, please. Yes, Vice Chair Gould.
I move that the school board approve Resolution 14-22, Native American Alaska Heritage Month, as presented.
Thank you. May I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmick. All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
All those opposed say no. Thank you. Motion carries. All right, and we are now at 6.01. This is public comments and requests. In accordance with school board policy BDDH, the time for each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. And additional written statements may be submitted to the clerk for dissemination to the board members and for the record. Ms. Goodell, do we have any public comments this evening?
No, we do not.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, we're now at 7.01. If someone could, this is our closed meeting. If someone could read us into closed, please. Yes, Ms. Tice.
Pursuant to the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, I move that the board convene a closed meeting for the following purpose: to discuss or consider the identified subject matter, personnel under section 2.2-3711A1, in particular, staff appointments, staff reassignments, staff resignations, staff retirements, staff performance, staff change in position, staff separation, dependent care leave, long-term medical leave, child care leave requests and leave of absence, and school board advisory committee appointments, and student matters under section 2.2-3711A2, in particular, non-resident tuition students, and legal matters under section 2.2-3711A8, in particular, consultation with legal counsel employed or retained by the public body regarding specific legal matters requiring the provision of legal advice by such counsel.
Thank you, Ms. Tice. May I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmock. All those in favor say yes.
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 All those opposed say no. Thank you. Motion carries. Dr. Noonan, what are your estimates on how long this closed meeting will take?
20 minutes.
Okay. Thank you. So all those who are watching can see if Dr. Noonan's right. But we'll see you hopefully in about 20 minutes. Thank you.
Mr. Reitinger, you should have gotten a link for closed session.
Okay, we are back. We're at 7.03. If someone, if I could please seek a motion to reconvene us to open.
Chair, I move that the board reconvene to open meeting.
Thank you. May I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Vice Chair Gould. All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
All those opposed say no. Thank you. Motion carries. We are now at 8.01. If someone could please certify the closed meeting.
Whereas the Falls Church City School Board has convened a closed meeting on this date pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote and in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas Section 2.2-3711B of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by this school board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law, now therefore be it resolved that the Falls Church City School Board hereby certifies that, to the best of each member's knowledge, only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirement by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which this certification applies, and only such public business matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmock. May I have a second, please?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Ortiz. Ms. Goodell, could you please call the roll?
Yes. Dr. Dimmock?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Dr. Gould?
Yes.
Dr. Ortiz?
Yes.
Mr. Reitinger? Mr. Reitinger? Okay. Ms. Silverman?
Yes.
And Ms. Tice?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. We are now at 9.05, the consent agenda. And I would like to ask for unanimous consent to approve the consent agenda. And hearing no objections, the consent agenda is approved. And we're now at 10.01 school start times, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, Chair Downs. Good evening again, everyone. It's a privilege tonight to be able to share some research and some work that both Kristen Michael and William Bates, our Chief Operating Officer and Chief Academic Officer, respectively, have done regarding the questions that have come up regarding school start times in the City of Falls Church. So, this evening, they've put together a presentation that they'd like to share for your information and consideration, and at this time, I'll turn it over to them. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Noonan. Good evening, Board. When we look at our agenda this evening, the things that we really want to talk about are the current school hours, so we'll give you that information. We'll also talk about our model for transportation, implications that a change might have on athletics. We'll also look at the history of our school start times, and then any challenges that we might anticipate for adjusting our school start times. Looking at our secondary school start times, we have a secondary campus model, which we're very proud of, And so our schools, Meridian and Mary Ellen Henderson, are functioning on a, they have the same schedule. And so the regular day, which starts at 8:05 and ends at 3 p.m., that offers 6 hours and 55 minutes of instructional time for each of the schools. On early release days, which would be 8:05 to 12:10 for both of the schools, we offer our students 4 hours and 5 minutes of instructional time. There we go. So looking at our current school times for our youngest learners, Jesse Thackeray Preschool, they have an arrival time of 8:15 and a dismissal time of 2:20, which offers our youngest learners 6 hours and 5 minutes of instruction. And then for Mount Daniel and Oak Street, we also have them operating on the same bell schedule, and that allows our students 7 hours of instructional time with a day that begins at 8:50 and ends at 3:50. And then for both Mount Daniel and Oak Street, as well as JTP, on any early release days, our students are getting about 4 hours and 25 minutes of instructional time. Yeah, things get...
One more. So in terms of our transportation model, Falls Church City Public Schools, like most other school divisions, use what's known as a tiered transportation model. And by tiered, what it means is our drivers make multiple runs. In our case, and it's similar to some of the other surrounding school divisions, first our drivers do a secondary run, then some of them do a preschool run, and then all of them do the elementary run following that. So it's seen as a tiered model because there are three different tiers. So if we look at this slide with the secondary morning schedule, you'll see that our buses typically leave the property yard at 7 a.m. After they leave the property yard at 7 a.m., they start picking up their first students at 7:14 a.m. And our students that are picked up earliest is that bus that will later be doing a Jesse Thackeray preschool run. At 7:35, our first buses start arriving at the secondary campus. And then by 7:50, all of our buses have arrived at the secondary campus, which is just about 15 minutes before school starting at 8:05. When we then look at Jesse Thackeray Preschool, those buses are going to leave from the secondary campus about 7:40. So remember, those were the buses that dropped their kids off earliest in terms of the runs for the secondary campus. So the buses leave the secondary campus and they're going to start picking up the preschool students. The first JTP student would be picked up around 7:48. And buses arrive at Jesse Thackeray Preschool between 8:05 and 8:15, and school starts at the 8:15 timeline. Then when we look at our elementary school schedules, the buses, the majority of them are departing from the secondary campus. Some would be departing from their Jesse Thackeray Preschool runs. So the first elementary students are picked up at 8:12 a.m. The buses then are departing JTP just a little bit after that, 8:15. Buses all then arrive at our elementary schools by 8:50 with the school start time for elementary of 8:50 a.m. When we look at our transportation routes compared to surrounding jurisdictions, we tend to have shorter transportation routes based on the geographic size of our locality. And this slide just gives you some of the transportation time runs for the surrounding jurisdictions. When we look at our secondary buses, our secondary pickup times start at 7:14 and the last one comes in at 7:40. So we really do have a number of kind of earlier runs that then transition onto Jesse Thackeray Preschool. But when we look at our average pickup time for secondary start, it's 7:28 in the morning. So our buses are picking up secondary students anywhere between 25 and 51 minutes before the first bell.
So looking at athletics, so it's no secret that we're unique in Falls Church City. We have a lot of our students who participate in multiple sports across multiple seasons, and we're also very small, and so because of our size, Many of the teams that we play in district and out of district cause us to travel and sometimes travel a pretty sizable distance. When we looked at our various seasons, we were able to gather some numbers for our fall sports from this current fall season. And then when we looked at winter and spring, those numbers are last year's numbers. But for our fall sports, we had 50 plus students participate in football, 30 plus in volleyball, 20 plus in cheer, 50 plus in cross country, and 12 in golf. And so we wanted to share that with you just to give you an idea of the number of students who might be impacted if there are challenges with schedules and traveling and release times. We had approximately 17 trips depart prior to 3:15 p.m. So that would be any student who's playing a sport that has to travel for an away game. They need to be released, and they need to be able to travel to that game and have themselves prepared and ready for competition prior to the game beginning. The majority of the travel prior to or released prior to 3:15 did come with our cross country team and those competitions that they were involved in. With ending school at 3 p.m., the cross country team has missed approximately 6 hours and 45 minutes of instructional time. And we had Mr. Brian Park, our athletic director, pull those numbers for us. Our winter sports, because our winter sports are indoors, typically we would see less of an impact. Oftentimes the numbers are going to be smaller with your indoor sports as far as numbers of students participating. And then when we look at our spring sports, again, these numbers or any numbers that we have here are included from last spring. But our JV games, they typically had a start time of 5:30. And as I had shared earlier, for any game, our students or student athletes need to arrive up to an hour prior to the game for their pregame prep. We had teams also depart between 3:15 and 3:30 for a majority of our contest. And so given our current schedule, students who are leaving in that 3:15 to 3:30 time frame, there's going to be less of an impact. The travel times range between 45 minutes, but they can and sometimes often range up to an hour and 30 minutes. And then track and field with weekday events, they have our earliest departures. And track and field is typically our largest participation sport with right around 80 students last year. Looking at the history of our school start times, back in or prior to 2005, our George Mason High School, our old high school, had a 7:45 a.m. start time. And the elementary school started at 8:35. In 2005, with the opening of Mary Ellen Henderson, we were required by VDOT to have a 30-minute staggered schedule for our schools due to the congestion concerns. And at that point in time, there was staff input and community input, and options were presented, and it also included a 7:30 a.m. start time for our elementary schools. And so we had a 7:30 to 2:30 p.m. school day for our middle school. Our high school had an 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. school day, and our elementary schools had an 8:45 to 3:45 school day. And again, as mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, we've really been pleased with having an identical schedule for our elementary schools as well as our two high schools. C- Continuing with previous adjustments to our school times, in 2014-2015, we were able to have our middle and high school adjusted to align our bus schedules. And so we had an 8:10 to 3:20 middle school bell schedule and a 8 a.m. to 2:55 high school bell schedule. And in 2016 to present, that's where we've experienced that identical schedule or aligned schedule for both Mary Ellen Henderson and now Meridian High School. And then in 2021, we made some adjustments to JTP and we extended their day. And so they are now at a 2:05 p.m. They went from a 2:05 p.m. dismissal to a 2:15 dismissal. And we needed to do that to adhere to our VPI, which is the Virginia Preschool Initiative requirements, which we aligned to.
So looking at some of the potential challenges in terms of schedule changes, operationally, if we were to change start times, there could be impact to both daycare and other childcare. So for example, if elementary started earlier, maybe fewer families would need before school care, but then perhaps more would need after school care due to there being a longer time between elementary dismissal and when parents come home. Impacts to schedules could also potentially impact our employees who have childcare or other jobs that they perform outside of FCCPS. So for example, if they're working a second job after their shift ends or before their shift starts, if they're coming in later in the day. When we look at transportation challenges, as I mentioned, we currently have drivers on a tiered transportation schedule. Next slide. And when we look at that schedule, our drivers are doing a secondary run first and then an elementary run. So we're using the same drivers and the same buses for making those routes. If we were to start elementary and secondary at the same time, what we would effectively need to do would be to double our bus fleet, so purchase at least 15, probably some additional spares, so a few more buses than 15, and we would also need to hire an additional 15 drivers. The bigger challenge is when we look at our bus drivers in terms of recruiting and hiring, we hire bus drivers right now typically with a 5-hour-a-day schedule. So they work 2.5 hours in the morning and 2.5 hours in the afternoon. And if they were to only do one tier, not a multiple tier run, and their time would decrease, we would be trying to get people to come in and work a split shift in the morning of approximately 1 hour to 1.5 hours, and then be off until they worked another hour and a half at the end of the day. When we look at some surrounding jurisdictions in terms of their tier bus schedules, one of the things that they do in terms of recruiting drivers is they add more tiers than 3. So some of the drivers we've hired from Fairfax County have reported up to making 4 runs in the morning and 4 runs in the afternoon by the school division spreading out their start times, which gives that bus driver 8 hours a day in terms of their work schedule. So in addition to the additional cost of purchasing additional buses and additional drivers, we would really need to look at our ability to hire people for a reduced amount of time in the morning and the afternoon. Then, if we were to dismiss elementary prior to the secondary runs, the other operational challenge that we face is our current practice for Mount Daniel students is when their parents are not at the bus stop at the end of the day, the drivers return the students to Mount Daniel and then their parents pick them up there. If the drivers were doing an elementary run prior to a secondary run, returning the students to Mount Daniel would make them late, probably about 20 minutes late, in terms of then starting their secondary run. Right now, it does sometimes impact our extracurricular athletic events after school. So that is just another thing we would want to keep in mind in terms of transportation challenges.
So when we looked at the implications on athletics, we wanted to highlight that if we push back the dismissal time to 3:30, want to keep in mind that our athletes would still need to, for the most part, be dismissed by 3 p.m. And on average, that would be 30 minutes of missed instructional time. As I mentioned before, Mr. Mr. Park, our athletic director, was able to pull some numbers and run some numbers for us. And what he shared was that in the spring of 2021, our athletics, they took 5 soccer trips. So we're talking about away games, away competitions where students had to be dismissed to be able to travel to other schools, somewhat locally, primarily outside of this immediate region. But so we had 5 soccer trips, 13 baseball or softball trips combined, 5 lacrosse trips, 16 tennis dismissals, and 4 track and field dismissals. And all of these events caused our students to need to be dismissed before 3:30 p.m. So that's a total of 43 dismissals for our sports travel. This is a result of instructional time for approximately 350 student athletes. Just kind of finishing up on that, if we approximate 30 minutes of additional lost instructional time for those 43 athletic events where students needed to be dismissed early in a given season, we would be talking about, we're estimating around 21 hours of lost instructional time for the athletes.
And then our last challenge is a significant challenge, and it's our 2232 agreement with Fairfax County. So Mount Daniel is located in Fairfax County, and in 2018, when the addition and renovation was made, we had to agree to specific conditions with Fairfax County government in order for the project to be approved. And those restrictions significantly limit our instructional times at Mount Daniel. So we cannot, per that agreement, begin classes any earlier than 8:50 a.m., and we're not allowed to end any later than 4 p.m. each day. Right, so that's a significant limitation in terms of making adjustments to that schedule. Also included in that 2232 agreement, capacity at Mount Daniel is limited to a capacity of 660 students. And then we also had limitations in terms of school size and parking spaces. So thank you for the opportunity for us to present this to you this evening.
Thank you very much, Ms. Michael and Mr. Bates, very informative. I'll turn it over to the board now for questions and comments. Yes, Ms. Tice.
Thank you so much. This was really helpful, and I know we've been asking for it for a while, so I appreciate you taking the time to kind of walk us through that, and I hope if the community is watching now, or maybe they'll watch at a later date with the links shared. I just I had a couple follow-up questions. One, I was wondering if I think a lot of this request for this information comes from all of the research that's come out about teenagers and sleep and their natural sleep rhythms and how detrimental it is to their mental health when they don't get enough sleep. I think there's been a lot of research. I'm sure a lot of us have read and heard about the, you know, American Academy of Pediatrics and the CDC coming out and the state of California coming out and saying school can't start before 8:30, or high school secondary campuses can't start before 8:30. So I think there's some significant and important conversations to be had among the community and what the sleep hygiene of our, especially our secondary students, looks like and what that means for their mental health. It's interesting when we talk about sports, and I think that information is really helpful in terms of when they leave and how much instructional time that our athletes are already missing. But I think about the opposite side of that question, too, and what the data would be on how many of our athletes are getting home from their events at 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, and beyond, and what that's doing. I don't know if we have that data. I know you don't have it at the ready, but I don't even know if the athletic director could compile some of that data in terms of how many time, how often are our athletes getting home at a late enough hour? And I know we do have some policies that allow them to come in an hour or maybe 2 hours late when they get back exceptionally late from a sporting event. So I think little things like that are helpful. And I just wanted to bring that piece up. And then I was also curious about returning students to Mount Daniel, and if we have any sense of how often that happens. I mean, I as a parent, I got that call once when my kid got on the wrong bus and got returned home, but I don't know how often in terms of what kind of, I understand that the piece with Fairfax County could be challenging. I'm not sure what options we have there, but
the other piece without Daniel. Do we have a sense of how often that happens?
I don't have the data in terms of how many times. It's very interesting. We always seem to struggle a lot at the beginning of the year. And the other place that we struggle is on short Wednesdays. But I'm not sure we're even keeping track of how often the cars come back. Right. I would have to check with both Principal Kasich and Transportation.
Right. Again, I just appreciate it. I don't think it's like so many things we wrestle with. I don't think there's a clear, obvious answer and a solution that will please everyone. I mean, that's the challenges with these sorts of things. But I really appreciate just opening the conversation and putting the information out there so that the community and the board understands all the factors at play.
Thank you, Ms. Tice. Dr. Dimmick, did you have a comment?
Yes, thank you very much for your presentation. I don't know if it may or may not be helpful to everyone. I looked up school start times for some of our neighboring jurisdictions. So Fairfax High Schools start at 8:10 and go to 2:55. Arlington is 8:20 to 3:10, except for HB Woodlawn, and they go from 9 to 3:50. Does HB not play sports, or
it's
do they not?
It's an alternative high school?
Right. Yes. But I guess one thing that I wondered from the transportation portion of your discussion is, from the whole discussion, it sounds like it would be a real challenge for us to change our start times. But those residents who are getting picked up at 7:14 or 7:15 for an 8:05 start time in the city of Falls Church, where it takes 10 minutes to get someplace, can we get them more sleep by picking them up a little bit later?
So I do believe those earliest pickup buses are the buses that are then dropping those students off at the high school, and they're starting their pickups early for Jesse Thackeray Preschool. But I do think it is something we can look at in terms of exactly how tight do we have those runs, and is there anything we could do to make it later?
I do think that's speaking from my personal experience, we actually drive our kids in because they get an extra half hour sleep. So I mean, I think that's why you see people driving sometimes, is to give their kids some more sleep, just for what it's worth. Any other comments or questions? Yes, Dr. Ortiz.
First, I want to really appreciate all the detail. The detailed presentation. I really feel that it's pretty clear that there's a delicate dance that occurs in terms of actually getting students to school, getting all the students to all the different schools to school, and then back home, and then getting athletes where they need to go. It's pretty well established medically that high school students have delayed sleep cycles, and it's beneficial to their physical and mental health as well as their academic achievement to start school later. I don't think that that's a disputable concept at all. And therefore, I think if we're, as a board, I am going to resist, you know, actually I'm not going to allow us to kind of wave this away as like, oh, well, this would be a big challenge, you know, so let's not think about it, or let's just like table it. No, we should really be talking about it. I think if we're starting a new school district, right, you know, we didn't have anything to think about, we were just planning the whole thing out, that's where we would start. We'd be saying, well, you know, the high school students need to sleep a little longer. You know, they're going to be up later doing stuff, so we're going to start them later. Now, when and how and under what conditions, et cetera, we're going to do that. You know, so I think it's like, you know, and I appreciate athletics, but I don't think that necessarily that's necessarily a primary concern that I have in terms of, you know, when school starts, you know, especially for everybody, right? You know, I think if, you know, if you make a choice to participate in an extracurricular activity, you know, there are certain trade-offs that come with that, you know. And, you know, I recall when I was in high school and I had double sessions for swimming, and they started at 6:30 and then again at 3:30, right? You know, you just have to do it, right? You know, and it's the way it goes, and you kind of suffer through it. So I really would like us to, you know, understanding this as like the baseline of the difficulties that we would face, you know, notwithstanding the fact they would have to negotiate an agreement with Fairfax County, you know, and that's a long-term thing to think about, is to think, okay, well, how can we, what are ways in which we can help to you know, A, mitigate this in the near term, as Dr. Dimmick brought up, but also, you know, try to get ourselves on a path, you know, and, you know, how long would that take? I'm guessing probably 5 or 6 years if we were really committed to make that happen. Because I think it's critical that if we're really committed to the well-being of our students, that we take actions like this And they are difficult, and they require us to make trade-offs and to think hard about it. And there are financial implications. I don't think we would go to a single-tier bus model, but, like, you know, we'd have to probably procure a couple of extra buses, and that's going to have implications, and there's other issues along with that. So I really appreciate, you know, this. This, you know, educates me on the challenges and the difficulties, and, you know, it's not something that would bring up, for, you know, propose to bring up as a resolution, but, you know, perhaps if we knew some more about exactly the benefits, we wouldn't be the first school district that would be proposing such a change, so maybe we could hear from other districts around the country that have made this change and how they manage this and how they manage transportation and athletic schedules and everything else. You know, I know, for example, you know, just anecdotally, that some extracurricular activities in a friend's school occur in the morning because school starts at 9, and so there's time in the morning for those to occur. So, you know, so I would like to continue this conversation. You know, maybe set aside this briefing and then maybe talk more about the benefits and then how transitions are made. And then we probably have to talk to our neighbors as well. There's a whole lot of steps to go into it. But I would hope that this isn't the end of the conversation.
Thank you, Dr. Ortiz. Yes, Vice Chair Gould.
Yeah, I appreciate putting this together. I think clearly there's a lot of sources and a lot of factors that are considered. I mean, this is the complexity of this issue, I think, is helpful for all of us to understand and get caught up on all that. I know you've done this before a few years ago, but for us as well as the community that is pushing for the conversation, I think I'd just echo Dr. Ortiz's comments. I think this is a good starting point for us to have this discussion. I think this is a very complex issue operationally, but the research is significant. The research is out there. The organizations that we have referred to before for our guidance are clear in their recommendations around start times for later start times for our high school students. And I agree. I think the athletic issue is important. However, they're not going to these events every single day, whereas our students are going to school every single day, and all of our students. So I think this is a large issue. I think to Dr. Ortiz's point, if the will of the board is to really continue to explore this as a conversation with the central office in terms of partnership, this is a policy issue. I think we saw this in California. They do have an exemption for rural districts, so we should make sure we note that if the operational considerations are not there, they don't have to comply with this to the level of the 830. But there are other states, Massachusetts, I think New York, New Jersey, and I think even the Virgin Islands are considering similar state policies for an 830 start time to align with the American Academy of Pediatrics. So I agree. I think these are compelling reasons for possibly not being able to do this, especially the Fairfax 2232, you know, in terms of trying to change that. But I think it would be good for us to explore this as a board in conjunction with you all to see if this is something that we would explore. So that's my comments.
Thank you, Vice Chair Gould. Yes, Ms. Silverman.
I have a question. If just merely flipping the secondary and Jesse Thackeray transportation runs, so not touching the Mount Daniel piece, and when my daughter was at Jesse Thackeray, we started a lot earlier. I think she got picked up at like probably around 7:15 in the morning. What are the challenges of flipping those two runs?
Thank you for the question. So the number of buses aren't equal. We have 15 buses that are making the secondary runs and the elementary runs, but only 4 buses are making the Jesse Thackeray run in between. So in terms of flipping them, we couldn't complete all of the secondary runs in that short window for JTP. I don't think, like, looking at the timing.
Okay. I was curious what the challenges would be.
Yeah, and it's because we're really kind of effectively squeezing JTP in, and we're doing that by getting those kids to high school and middle school at the very earliest, and then they're squeezing in the Jesse Thackeray run, and then those kids are typically the ones that are getting to elementary the latest on the other end.
Okay, thanks.
Yes, Dr. Dimick.
About athletics. So we are a small school district. We play other small school districts. Athletics isn't my thing, so feel free to correct me. At some point, might we drive less far to compete? Is that on the horizon for us at some point in time?
It's somewhat dependent on our enrollment. You know, you're categorized size by the number of students you have in your building. And because our population at Meridian is around 875 or so, it puts us in a certain class. And we always play high schools that are similar sized. There aren't very many high schools in the region that are of similar size. And so our only option would be to play up. And I think that there's some prevailing concerns regarding the safety of students playing up, particularly in football and some of the contact sports. So I don't anticipate that in the next, we just went through what's called an R&R cycle, which is a redistricting and realignment process with the Virginia High School League. And that new alignment starts this coming year. So they won't realign for two more years. I don't anticipate that our enrollment's going to grow significantly in the next 2 years to move us to a different class that would then allow us to play, for example, closer to home.
Anyone else? Okay, well, thank you, Ms. Michael and Mr. Bates. Thank you again. And, you know, it does seem that the consensus in the board is that to continue this conversation. And so what Vice Chair Gould and I will do, we'll talk with Dr. Noonan and figure out, you know, I think to me one of the glaring pieces is that Fairfax agreement. You know, I get not glaring, but what I guess one of the big pieces of this would be that Fairfax agreement. So Vice Chair Gould and I will talk with Dr. Noonan and we'll figure out next steps and, you know, continue the conversation. Okay. Thank you very much. We're now at 10.02, Weldon Cooper's enrollment projections, and I will turn it back over to Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, and Dr. Dimmock, you gave us a perfect segue with asking a question about R&R and enrollment. As I think everybody here is very aware, it is budget time in the City of Falls Church, and one of the things that is really important that we look at as we go through our budget process is what our enrollment projections are for the coming year and then looking out as well. So this evening, Kristen Michael, our Chief Operating Officer, has put together a presentation incorporating the Weldon Cooper Center's enrollment projections. As an aside to that, I did want to inform the board that in the last budget cycle, we did set aside some money for a demographer. And the city manager, Wyatt Shields, and I continue to talk about what that will look like. We don't have, and it will come up at the December meeting. I believe that it's on the agenda for a brief conversation. But we are continuing to look at what a demographer can do to help us become more refined in our projections. Although what we're finding is that the year-over-year projections from Weldon Cooper do fall within a range of about plus or minus 2% from 99% accuracy. It's the out years that get a little bit complicated. And in the City of Falls Church, it's gonna be even more complicated because we do have a lot of growth going on. So this evening, for you, we'd love to share the student enrollment projections as we head into the budget cycle. So with that, I'll turn it over to Ms. Michael.
Thank you so much for the opportunity this evening to present the enrollment projections that were developed by the Weldon Cooper Center at the University of Virginia. So each year, we receive projections for the upcoming 15 years from the Weldon Cooper Center. And when we look at those projections, generally the accuracy of those projections kind of diminishes as we get farther out in that planning horizon. And as Dr. Noonan indicated, these projections really are the beginning of our budget process each year. So we start with, for Weldon Cooper, by providing them with the September 30th enrollment calculation. So we submit that data to the state as of September 30th, and then we also immediately send it to Weldon Cooper. And they use the current year's enrollment data as the base. So this is a chart that we typically share each year at this time that looks at what the previous year's actual enrollment was. So for this chart, we have 2019, 2020, 2021, and 2022. And then we also show what was the projection for the school year, FY23, what was our enrollment as of September 30th, And then what was the variance with the projection that Weldon Cooper gave us last year? And then what was the projection with the prior year actual? So for example, kindergarten is on the top line. Our projection for 23 was 166 students. We had 133 enrolled as of September 30th. So we were 33 students fewer than was projected and 24 students fewer than last year. When we look at this chart on the bottom line, overall in terms of our student enrollment, we were 32 students higher than we had projected for the year and 32 students higher than actual as of September 30th. So on the next chart, when we look at this chart, it shows the projection in the red line and the actual enrollment in the blue line. And they provide this chart to us each year, and it's very helpful to look at where do we have a significant gap between what they projected and what actually occurred. And as you can see on this chart, we have a significant gap in kindergarten, which is consistent. Generally, kindergarten is a very difficult year to project. And this year, we also had a more significant gap at sixth grade and 12th grade. Typically, we see new students coming to our district in kindergarten, grade six, and grades nine. This chart compares the projection sets. So if we look back, Weldon Cooper last fall provided us with three different projection sets. And the three sets they gave us, each one had a different amount of years, previous year's history that was used in their projection. So they gave us a short-term set that looked at data from the prior 2 years, a medium-term set looking at 4 years of data, and a long-term projection set looking at 6 years back. So this chart, which is kind of hard to see on the screen, shows us in the far left bar what that short-term projection was. The second bar from the left is the medium term. The long-term projection is in gray, and then the far bar in yellow in each set is what our actual enrollment is. So you can see in terms of kindergarten, for all three projection sets last year, they gave us the same projection, and our actual enrollment came in lower. And this information is important because Weldon Cooper each year gives us multiple projection sets. So we really use this to look back. Last year when we had picked our projection set, we had picked the short-term projection set. So it's important to consider this data as we're looking at their projections moving forward. They also have given us data, and we calculated what is our historical enrollment been from 2001 through 2022, the fall of 2022. Which is school year 22-23. And this stacked bar chart has every single grade in a stacked color, and it shows what our total enrollment was. So you can see how our enrollment was growing, and then when the pandemic started, it had dropped, and it's risen slightly since then, but we're really kind of close to where we were at that pandemic year. When we look at our speakers for English speakers of other languages, this chart shows the students that are receiving those additional services. And we've included a multi-year history as well. So this chart starts with 2017-18 and goes all the way through this current school year, which is 2022-2023. And then we provide a change for this current fall compared to the prior fall. Again, this is all important information as we think of staffing for next year. As we're developing our budget. So when we look at this chart, the top section of the chart are those students receiving services in English for speakers of other languages. So when you look at this current school year, we have 124 students receiving services, and that's an increase of 9 or 7.8% from last year. The middle section are those students that are exiting services, and then the bottom is students who refuse services. The next chart looks at other services that we provide to students. So the top line of this chart are students that are eligible for free or reduced price meals. And when we look at that enrollment for this year, we have increased. We're up to 225 students, and that's an increase of 30 students from last year, or over 15%. The next line shows our students with disabilities. These are students that have an IEP, and that number increased to 352 for this school year, or an increase of 14. Or 4.1%. This year, we're also providing information on students with a 504 plan. And a 504 plan helps students ensure they have equitable access in a learning environment. That went from 185 to 173, so down 12 students or 6.5%. The next line are students that are homeschooled or have a religious exemption. This year we have 37 students, so that's an increase of 2 from the prior year, but that is significantly down from the school year of 2020 to 2021. And then the last line that we've included, which is also new information for this evening, is we've included how many students outside of Jesse Thackeray Preschool are tuition students. So students who live outside our jurisdiction but are paying tuition to be enrolled. And that number for this year has increased to 18, which is the highest that we have seen. And this is data that was as of a week or so ago. So that was up 3 students or 20% from last year. So when we look at the enrollment projection process from Weldon Cooper, as I indicated, we send them our data as of September 30th, and then they provide us with projections. They provide projections not only for us, but they also do the statewide projections that are used to allocate sales tax to all the divisions across the state. So Weldon Cooper, when they're developing their projections, they use birth data and fall membership data. And they receive that birth data from the Virginia Center for Health Statistics. And that they use that in terms of projecting future years' births. And then they receive membership information from jurisdictions like ourselves, as well as from the Virginia Department of Education. So the method that Weldon Cooper uses is called the grade progression ratio method. And what that does is they take the enrollment data by grade and they use a grade progression ratio to project enrollment for the next year. And that captures a pattern of cohorts of students as they move from grade to grade. And because this fluctuates so much each year, they use multiple years in their set, and that's where they're getting the short, long, and medium averages. So that's how they develop those projection sets. So what is a grade progression ratio? So a grade progression ratio is developed by dividing the number of students who are in a specific grade by the number of students from the previous grade in the prior year. So if we take the second grade students and divide them by the first grade progression ratio, to get that, we find it by dividing the current number of second grade students by the number of students who were in first grade the prior year. So a progression ratio that's greater than 1 is shown on their chart as greater than 100%. What that means is there are more new students than the number of students who left from the prior year. So if we have a grade progression ratio of less than 1 or less than 100%, that means we had more students leave than we had move in. So this chart is a graphical representation of the grade progression ratio of students moving to the next grade. The top line is kindergarten. And again, kindergarten didn't have students in the prior grade, so that's based on birth data. And you can clearly see from this chart, kindergarten is where we've had really the greatest variance in terms of our enrollment projections. And then this chart is showing the grade progression ratio in these stripes for students in 6th, 9th, and 12th grade are in those blue and purple hues. And then they've also provided us with the data, so you can look at what that grade progression ratio was for every single grade. And this goes from 2010 all the way through 2022 in the fall. So when we look at factors that are impacting progression, factors that are impacting projections. Weldon Cooper is giving us projections for 15 years out, but they're really only relying on a few items, right? They're relying on state population data, right, looking at enrollment, and they're also looking at birth data. And what they've told us is when they look out at the 15-year projections, they have found that the students that were missing in 2020 due to COVID, the students who left public education, most of them have returned. So on a statewide basis, they're saying they're putting our projections really fairly close to where they were in 2019, right? And they caveated 2 differences. The main difference that our high school is still missing some students. And then based on this, they're saying on the longer term, the projection is expecting just enrollment to slightly lower than our 2019 projections. So when we continue looking at factors that impact enrollment growth, the factors that Weldon Cooper really pointed out for us are in Northern Virginia, there's been a shift to remote work. And they're saying that shift to remote work has really caused a considerable decrease in the number of people that are moving into the region. And the example that they provided to us is that Amazon, who moved their second headquarters into Arlington, brought thousands of jobs with them when they came. But overall, Arlington's population is still smaller than it was 5 years ago. So they said that impact of remote work and where people need to live is the biggest question in demography when they look at long-term projections for divisions like us and the state as a whole. The one significant factor that Weldon Cooper does not include in their enrollment projections at all is our local housing impact. So remember, Weldon Cooper's really looking at statewide population data, enrollment, and birth rates. So when we look at Falls Church, we have a significant number of residential units that are under construction that are going to potentially impact our enrollment. So under construction currently, we have West Falls, Founders Row, and Broaden Washington, as well as Founders Row 2 and the One City Center project that are under review. So this slide indicates the number of units in each of those developments that could add to future enrollment that is not included in this projection set. So this ties back to the discussion with Dr. Noonan and Wyatt Shields regarding a demographer to better help us understand this potential impact. When we look at birth rates in Northern Virginia, Weldon Cooper's reporting that birth rates have dropped sharply in recent years. They noted that birth rates did rebound in 2021, but they still remain lower than they were a few years ago. Weldon Cooper also pointed out that Falls Church is one of the more attractive parts of Northern Virginia, but they still believe that those lower birth rates will cause our enrollment to decline. And this next slide is a chart on annual birth rates that they provided to us. So the blue bars show births in the region, and that scale is shown on the left side of the chart. And then the red line are births in Falls Church City, and that those values are on the right side of the chart. So this year, again, Weldon Cooper has provided us with those three projections. They use the same methodology in terms of a short, medium, and long-term projection set. So when we look at the projections they gave us, we're going to be moving forward using the long-term projections. So that looks at the impacts over the last 6 years. And we think using 6 years of data will help us mitigate that impact of COVID. And again, their projections exclude Jesse Thackeray Preschool. So these charts show you what those three projection sets were, and then looking at what the enrollment impacts were. For example, as we look at the projection for next fall, their short-term set had us going up 13 students, their medium projection set had us going down 8 students, and the long-term projection set shows us increasing by 13 students for next year. This is a graphical representation. The red line on this chart shows our enrollment and actual enrollment from 2010 through this current school year. And then those three colored lines continuing on are showing the three different years of projection sets. The long-term set in these projections is the line that is in the middle of the short and medium-term sets shown in green on this chart. And then for reference, we did include a chart that shows the projections that they gave us by grade for each of those years. As Dr. Noonan indicated, this chart shows the Weldon Cooper Center's projection accuracy for each of the years. So this chart shows for each fiscal year what was the projected enrollment, what was the actual enrollment, and then what was the difference with the actual as compared to the projected. And then it also shows year-over-year growth, and then the year-over-year growth in the projections. So when we look at the bottom line for FY23, I'm using that long-term projection set. We are showing a difference of this current year. We had 32 more students than they had projected. So our actual versus projected was 101.3%. And then this is a line graph that also shows Weldon Cooper Center projection accuracy each year. Just so you can see the variance of that over time. And with that, I will wrap up the enrollment presentation. Thank you.
Can I ask you just to clarify one more time? So what is the bottom line number that we will be using for our projection for next year compared to our enrollment this year?
So the number we're going to use for our overall student enrollment projections for next year is 2,482 students. That's excluding Jesse Thackeray Preschool, and that is an increase of 13 students for next school year. So we would add Jesse Thackeray to that.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much, Ms. Michael and Dr. Noonan, for that clarification. I'll open it up to question and comments. Yes, Ms. Tice.
Thank you so much. I cannot imagine how you got through all that. It's a lot of numbers, but I learned so much sitting here. Thank you. My only question was just, I understand the real challenge of trying to predict the students that are going to come out of the construction coming down the pipeline, and I'm just wondering what information the city is able to give you in guiding that part of the estimate outside of what Weldon Cooper is able to do.
That's a great question, and it's one that we've sort of wrestled with probably for the last decade in Northern Virginia or more, actually. And there have been some modeling. There's been some modeling that's been done by demographers in the region that's been very, very good and fairly accurate based on the types of units that are being built currently in multiple sites. And so the factor for new construction on a traditional sort of one or even two bedroom unit is about a 0.17 yield. So that means for every 100 units that are built, you're going to get about 17 students. So if you look at the total number, if you were to take those and add them up, and let's just use the round number of 1,000 because it's easiest, when everything's said and done, after we've had 1,000 units put in, even if they're micro units, they tend to yield kids, and we see that just as an example at the apartments over by the Target. Those are smaller apartments, but they have the most buses that go over there. Over in Tinner Hill. So if we have 1,000 students, I think over the next 5 to 10 years, we could experience enrollment growth as much as 170 students if we have 1,000 at a 0.17 yield. And that changes, just by the way, over time. So as the years go by and the units age, and it's been about 8 years now, or 10 years now, so 1996 would be about the line of demarcation. 96 and prior would be sort of a bigger yield than the 0.17. So new units yield less kids, older units yield more. So you go from a 0.17 to about a 0.23 in anything prior to 1996. And the reason for that is as units get older, they become more affordable. Newer units tend to be more expensive. So we're expecting anywhere from 150 to 170 students over the next 5 to 10 years that are not accounted for in these enrollment figures.
Thank you, Ms. I do remember, and I can't remember if it was last year, but I remember the first year that Dr. Dimmick and I were on the board in the budget notebook. I remember there was a page that talked about all the different developments, and there was actually an estimate for each development, what they thought it would yield in terms of students.
Yeah, and we're still kind of looking at that, and I think that's why we want to get a demographer involved as well. But we do have that unit dwelling by unit by population chart that we've done, and I think we're going to we do that again. Plus, we're looking at sort of these numbers, and to start that, we wanted to make sure we had a good universe of the number of units for each.
Right, that makes sense.
Does the city have that information also? Surely they're factoring those sorts of things in when they're they're building.
And we provide them with that, the number of students for each dwelling type. We update that document every single late fall, and in early December of each year, we give it to the school board and city council.
It is an interesting dynamic at play between the general government, the city council, the schools, and the school board. And I've seen it not just here, but I've seen it in the city of Fairfax. I've seen it in Fairfax County as well, where those that are making decisions about bringing in units are less likely to agree that they're going to yield students. And those that have to deal with the students that those units are yielding say those units are going to yield students. And so there's this sort of dynamic at and push-pull between the entities. So I think we see some of that right now, and I in a meeting not too long ago, probably within the last year, someone on the city council asked me, well, how many kids do you think these units will yield, or how many kids do you think we'll get in the next 10 years? And I think my response was, well, it sort of depends on how many units are built. And I didn't mean that in a flip way. I meant it in, like, that really matters. Like, if we have 1,000 units that are being built, probably going to get 170 kids. If you build 500, we'll probably get 85. You know, it's just a matter of how many they're built, because it is formulaic. And now, because the region is so robust, the data sets are really strong and really do indicate through these models that that's the yield.
Well, it also seems to me that we've done so much work as a city to build all these beautiful units, but also to build out the capacity of our school buildings. Like, we're at the point now where we're comfortable, right? We have space in all of our school buildings. We shouldn't be scared of increased enrollment. We have, like, open the doors, let them in, and we've got the room.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think the only challenge there is it just means we hire more teachers. And I think that's the economic concern.
Well, open the doors and make sure we have the money to
yes,
do it well.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Agree with you.
From your mouth to city council's yes, Vice Chair Gold.
To what Chair Downs was mentioning about the projections of new development and how that actually matriculated into students, there is that data, it sounds like, from the general government side. Is that possible to look at that so we understand the impacts of development and at least the projections from that? Because I think, as Dr. Noonan said, that seems to be a question mark about how accurate those projections end up being. Do you have your counterpart that you could provide that data at some point?
I will ask the general government if they have projections for the units that are currently being built. The data that we provide to them is the actual outcome for each year for each apartment or condo or housing type. But I'll definitely ask them if they have more detailed projections for these developments that are currently in process.
Okay, because I think it's also, if possible, longitudinal, if they had projections in the past and how our enrollment, which we clearly have, how that was impacted. I know that might be what the consultant might be able to do, is to track that. I know longitudinally is easy to say but hard to do. But that's what I'm curious about, is how well their projections are lining up with how many students we actually enroll in the buildings.
And I think the challenge with that is we haven't seen growth like this in the city before. So we've got Founders Row just came online, so now we'll get a chance to see what happens at Founders Row. You know, when West Falls comes online, we'll get a chance to see. But we haven't seen large units like that, specifically with condo units. We've got a lot of apartments that we can look at, but absolutely we can dig in. And if we don't have it here, we can look at other jurisdictions as well.
Thank you. Any comments?
Ms. Michael, I have a question, and I'm not trying to put you on the spot by any means, but I just wanted a clarification. So on slide 8, under student services, I think that number changed today, didn't it?
It did. Thank you very much. I should have pointed that out. Previously, we had gotten preliminary economically disadvantaged numbers from food services, and they had reported 184 students. And then we clarified and reached back out to them, and they reported how many students as of today, and today it's 225.
Okay.
So we have seen a 40 student increase from earlier in the school year until now.
Okay. The reason I'm asking is last night at the Falls Church Education Foundation meeting, we were talking about the Family Assistance Fund. And so we were trying to figure out, like, the money that the Education Foundation has given out has decreased the past 2 years, which I think is because population overall has dropped because of COVID. So when I was looking at it today, I was like, oh, it's continuing to drop. And then I looked at it now, so it's not. So I think that's just because our population's picking back up, right?
And that is correct. We saw prior to the impact of COVID, our number of students receiving free and reduced meals was over 200. And then during the pandemic, that number had dropped.
Mm-hmm.
But now, as the school years continue to progress, we're back up to 225, which is higher than the prior year.
Okay, thank you. I'll make sure to let them know that.
And we're also not offering free meals to everybody.
Right.
Like we have in the past.
Right. That's true. Thank you. Any other comments or questions?
Just one quick comment, if I might, Chair.
Yes, please, Mr. Reitinger.
Thank you. The
it might be helpful if, you know, the chart that you were discussing that you mentioned before, which I've heard referred to before as, I think, the Chavern chart or the Kendall-Sharp chart. I'm happy to call it either or neither. You know, that's the most useful data, I think, that everyone should probably take a look at, because it, you know, it not only breaks down the newer developments by development and the older mid-rise developments, but also we're doing with single-family homes. So that's a pretty informative chart, and historically, it also would show some of the newer board members some of the unexpected things that can happen. For example, a change in the style of the complex in Falls Green can add or drop 50, 60, 70, or 80 students in a year, which can be a really significant change. So looking at some of the blips that have happened historically when models of renting have changed and when the pattern of development has changed could be pretty useful for people. So if perhaps the administration could reshare the most up-to-date version. I think Dr. Noonan said the new version is in development now, but that's a very useful historical document to look at, particularly as you go into budgeting each season.
Certainly can do that. Thank you, Mr. Redinger.
Yes, that's a great point. You're exactly right, because once Oakwood changed to Falls Green and whatever happened there, that population dropped a lot in terms of our students there. So that's a great point. Anything else? Okay, well, thank you again, Ms. Michael, for this really informative and interesting presentation. I think this will, again, whetting our appetite for budget season, so thank you very much. We're going to move on now to 10.03, FY23 budget amendment, and I'll turn this back over to Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, Chair Downs. This is the budget amendment that would allow us the opportunity to provide all of our employees a one-time $1,000 bonus. And as you may recall, there was a state superintendent memo that came out that would provide opportunities for bonus payments December 1st, 2022. The state is providing us $1,000 per SOQ-funded instructional and support position. And as you know, because of our size and our class sizes and the way that we staff beyond what the standards of quality require, which means that we wouldn't have enough to provide everybody with a $1,000 bonus if we gave it to everyone. So tonight, what we're asking for is additional funding of $285,531 to be transferred to the school from the school operating budget that would allow us to provide a $1,000 bonus to all of our employees, and that would come out of fund balance. It also would then bring the fund balance down to 1.8%, which is within our guidance, and that's a good number to be at as we go into the budget season, to be within your policy limit of 2%. So tonight we're requesting that you authorize this budget amendment so that we can provide that opportunity for our employees. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Noonan. And the attachment gives some good context and background. I'm sure you've all read that, so I think that was very informative. Are there any questions or comments on this? Oh, yes. Thank you. Mr. Reininger, do you have a question, comment? Your hand's still up. Thank you. Anyone else? Questions or comments? Okay. If I could, I'm seeking a motion on this item. Yes, Dr. Ortiz.
That the Falls Church City School Board approve expenditures of $527,130 utilizing revenue from the state of
Virginia. Sorry.
Not in there. To funding of $241,599 and fund balance of $285,531 to provide a one-time increment of $1,000 paid on November 30th for each contracted and long-term hourly employee who is not on a long-term leave status during the 2022 to 2023 school year and is employed as of November 15, 2022.
Thank you, Dr. Ortiz. May I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmock. All those in favor say yes.
Yes. Yes.
All those opposed say no. Okay, thank you. Motion carries, and again, we are happy to provide this
benefit for our teachers and staff, and you know, we are very grateful for all the work that they do. And so this is a happy agenda item. So thank you, everyone, for that support. And we'll move on now to Tim. Yes.
Just to make sure, since we did insert the name Virginia, can we just say adopted as amended?
Yes. I'm sorry. The motion is adopted as amended. And thanks. Thank you, Dr. Ortiz, for that on your feet thinking there. Without Miss, that's Mr. Reitinger's specialty. So, but anyway, again, thank you, and thank you to our staff and our teachers and Ms. Michael and Ms. Kopic for finding the money. But we really, you know, our teachers and our staff really, that's what it's all about. And so we're just very excited to provide this benefit for everyone. We're going to move on now to 10.04. That's the second reading and adoption of policies. And can I shoot it directly to Ms. Minson? Thank you.
Thank you and good evening. We have 9 policies for second reading this evening, most of which remain unchanged from first reading. The first policy is policy LI, Relations with Educational Accreditation Agencies. That would be replacing our current policy 6.4. There were no proposed, and by the exact same name as 6.4, there were no proposed changes from first reading. Any questions about policy LI? Seeing none, next is policy IJD, College and Career Readiness. This policy had previously been adopted by the board, and there were some additional changes and insertions based on changes to the Virginia Code. So it was last adopted July 10th, 2018. There were some proposals for additions at first reading. No changes were proposed at first reading. Any questions on policy IJD? Next is policy LBD, Home Instruction. There were this would be replace our current policy 9.23. There were no proposed changes from first reading. Any questions on policy LBD? All right, next is policy JD, student absences, excuses, dismissals. This is the one policy for second reading that does have some changes. You'll notice that there's language added regarding civic events at lines 18 to 20, thanks to our principals and school leaders for helping us come up with that language. Line 52 and line 64 changed it from and to or as the different options or different reasons for excused absences. Removed lines 66 to 67, permitting parents to excuse their students, and added references to the regulation CCR at lines 75 and 76, and added that reference to CCR in the cross-reference section on the final page of the policy. Any questions about this policy, JED, student absences, excuses, dismissals?
Yeah, Ms. Vincent, so the lines 75 and 76, are we missing, like, are we missing a comma or something? Because it just says regulation is like one sentence. I don't know if it's supposed to be.
Let me see.
Comma regulate. It just needs to be wordsmithed, I think.
Instead of a comma, regulation CCR, school
calendar.
Well,
no, like, it's just a standalone phrase that's made into
I see what you're saying. Hold on 1 second. I might have mistyped. So
I don't know, maybe holiday comma? I don't know, regulation.
Because it's a regulation, regulations can be changed. So we can add a school calendar, comma, religious holiday expectations, or maybe even a hyphen in there.
I think the question is, yeah. is that a sentence or is that a reference?
That is the title of the current regulation.
Right, but like if you read from starting 74, right, and then we just have that as a standalone sentence.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I mean, could we just add a footnote to that?
We could. We tend not to include footnotes in policies just for formatting reasons so that it can be accessible by a screen reader for somebody who has low vision.
Okay.
But we could say...
can we put it in parentheses?
Yes, yeah.
Just parentheses, regulation CC.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Does that have agreement from board? Thanks for talking me through that.
Yeah,
and then
I think it just didn't. It just seemed odd to me.
That's just kind of hanging out there.
Yeah,
that makes sense.
Just hanging out there.
Okay, we can certainly add that. Thank you. Any other questions about policy JED? Yes.
I just to let the board know I had been in touch with Ms. Minson about this policy. A community member asked about one-day excused absences for. Sporting activities that are not that are not school affiliated and having trouble having that as an excused absence. And also, I guess what occurred to me are, you know, college visits or excused absences. And I don't, and from your communication, Ms. Minson, the regulations should take care of this, and this should be okay at the school level.
That's correct, and we will work with school administration and folks who do attendance to make sure everybody understands expectations for parents granting excused absences for their students. Thank you.
To be even more clear, not that you weren't clear, but just to put sure. a finer point on it, maybe, if a parent excuses a student, we're not going to question them about why they're excusing their student. Right. We have these rules in place in case it's being abused, but you know, one of the things that we believe strongly in is in our parents and in our parent community and the relationship that we have with them. And if a parent were to call and excuse their child, we do ask for reasons, but we're not going to question them about whether it's real or not.
Yes, Ms. Silverman.
On that point, and I'm scrolling up back to line 66, where we took that line out, absence with parent guardian permission, but for reasons not on the excused absence list. I thought there was the whole conversation during first reading about parents trying to excuse their children from school that maybe weren't for reasons that we thought should be an excused absence. Like, I think the example that was given was that Ms. Reyes, when she was at the high school, would receive a call that, you know, so-and-so is going to be out prom dress shopping, and this is the only time they can do it. I think that was the example that we received. So is that now taken out of, so now a parent can excuse their children for any reason?
We're going to work with the parent. That it's a very rare case, so I'm not inclined. We took this out, I think, at the request of the board, because I don't know that we wanted to set policy based on, you know, one or two behaviors of some parents that we would work with individually.
Don't let the bad apples spoil the
yes.
bunch
yeah.
or whatever it's
right,
called.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's right.
That makes sense. Thank you for the clarification.
Thank you for those questions. Any other questions about policy JED? All right. The remaining five policies all relate to communicable diseases and bloodborne pathogens. Previously, we had policy 8.31 and 9.18. Those would be replaced by EBAB. The first one is called possible exposure to viral infections. There were no changes from first reading to that policy. Any questions about EBAB? The next policy is EBB, personnel training for viral infections. There were no changes from first reading to that policy. Questions about EBBB? All right, the third one is policy JHCC, GHCC. Mr. Redinger, you did ask a question about that policy, whether there was a state law regimen that governs the disclosure of employee communicable diseases. We were not able to find anything in the Virginia Code or the Virginia Administrative Code, so I would recommend no changes to this policy. Any questions about policy JHCC, GHCC? All right, then policy JHCCA, bloodborne contagious or infectious diseases. That we did receive a question from Dr. Ortiz, and we did run this policy and the next, the same letter policy, but with E at the end of it, by our public health nurse, and they confirmed that this has the most up-to-date guidance from the state and from the Virginia Department of Education. So we'll take the first one first, policy JHCCA, bloodborne contagious or infectious diseases. Any questions on that policy? All right, then the final policy for second reading is the JHCCA-E, Guidelines for School Attendance for Students with Human Immunodeficiency Virus. Any questions about that policy? Seeing none, those are the policies for second reading this night. To the extent that there were changes to policy JED, the motion would just say as amended. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Minson.
Yes, Dr. Ortiz.
Yeah, I just wanted to thank Ms. Minson and the team for looking into the group of health-related policies. I still feel they're somewhat anachronistic in the way that they're written. At the same time, however, I don't believe that a deep dive on the part of the board to try to engineer them would provide a significant amount of benefit. So I'm prepared to just support them as is. And if there's a case that we have to deal with where the policy needs to be either waived or amended, we can revisit it at that time.
Thank you, Dr. Ortiz. Could I have a motion, please? And then we just need to, do we say as amended right after we say JED or at the end of the, okay.
After JED would be great, okay, thank
so
you.
Just whoever's going to say, just make sure you say as amended after JED. Dr. Dimmick, you look like you're ready for this. Thank you.
Chair, I move that the school board approve second reading and adoption of policies LI, Relations with Educational Accreditation Agencies, IJD, College and Career Readiness, LBD, Home Instruction, JED, Student Absences, Excuses, Dismissals as amended, EBAB, Possible Exposure to Viral Infections, EBBB, Personnel Training Viral Infections, JHCC/GHCC, Communicable Diseases, JHCCA, Bloodborne Contagious or Infectious Diseases, and JHCCA-E, Guidelines for School Attendance for Students with Human Immunodeficiency Virus.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmick. May I have a second? Thank you, Vice Chair Gould. All those in favor say yes. Yes.
Yes.
All those opposed say no. Thank you. Motion carries. And I will turn it back over to Ms. Minson for first reading of policies.
Thank you. We have four policies for first reading this evening. The first is policy EBCD, school closings. We do not have a current policy that covers this language, but do think it makes sense to move to the model policy, which says the superintendent or designee may order the closing or delayed opening or early dismissal of schools. Any questions about policy EBCD, school closings? All right, next is policy CBA, qualifications and duties for the superintendent. This policy was previously adopted by the board in November of last year, and in reviewing our current policies, we realized there was a policy 3.6, that there was no corresponding model policy from the VSBA, but many of the elements of policy 3.6, which is titled Responsibilities of the Superintendent, are already included in this policy CBA. So the only addition to this policy at first reading would be to add the cross-reference to former policy 3.6 at the header of this and at the header of each of the pages. But because this involves removing a policy, entirely removing policy 3.6, rather than bringing it for waiver first reading, I'm bringing it just for first reading. So if there are questions about removing policy 3.6, I'd welcome those. Or questions about policy CBA.
I have a question. Oh, with my mic on.
Sorry, Vice Chair Gould.
Yes, please.
At risk of increasing the length of a job description to more than three pages, which I'm glad mine is not, the one aspect Dr. Noonan does well is engage with the community in terms of listening sessions and in terms of that kind of outreach. I do see certain sections here around community relation activities, but I wonder if there's a way to codify what he does with that active listening or, you know, kind of the equivalent of office hours. Where is that captured?
There's no express mention of office hours, but you're right. At page, and I realize I did not put the line numbers, at least on the copy that I'm looking at, so I'm so sorry about that. But the bottom of page 2 and the top of page 3, there are five bullets of the superintendent's community relations activities.
So if we were going to add a bullet, is that problematic since this is pulled from a previous template of a policy?
It would be adding an expectation for the superintendent that's not included in the Constitution, the Code of Virginia, or the Virginia Administrative Code, but it is within this board's purview if you'd like to do that. The only challenge in adding language to a policy is to the extent we're following the VSBA model policies, we'd want to make sure that if this policy came up with revisions from the VSBA, anything this board would want to include then is also aligned.
So. Yes. I think maybe we don't have to add a bullet, but if you could add just two words on the
second bullet of that collection. I think it's on the, it would be the first bullet on page three. It could be seeking and responding to concerns expressed in the community. And then, you know, that could, you know, exactly how well that was done can be handled within the context of the performance.
Vice Chair Gould, with that.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of the what Dr. Noonan does well, which is that proactive outreach as well. I that might do it. I'm just trying to process that. I would like to codify that somehow, what he does. I don't know if there, I like the idea of just expanding a bullet, though. I think that's, I don't know if that alleviates Ms. Minson's concerns about, or if you have any concerns. Sometimes I can't tell if it's a concern. You're just giving me a legal reason of
no
what's happening.
No concern. I think this okay. would be the discretion of the board to set the expectations.
Okay.
So would the board be okay with adding?
Or yes. Could you say seeking out, listening to, and responding to concerns expressed in the community?
That would. I think that codifies what he's doing now, which is yeah, which I think we would expect any superintendent to want to do. Yeah.
So did you get that, Ms. Minson?
Yep, we would okay. change the second bullet to seeking out, listening to, and responding to concerns expressed in the community on the top of page three.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks, everyone.
Sure. Any other questions about policy CBA? All right, next is policy CF, School Building Administration. In reviewing the policies in section three, this previously had no cross-references. But we did have policy 3.2 titled Definitions and Responsibilities of Administrators, 3.3 titled Lines of Responsibility, and 3.10 titled Principles. None of those policies have corresponding VSBA model policies, but policy CF does give kind of general expectations of school building administrators. So we did think it made sense to add the cross-references to policy CF. You'll also note that in addition to adding the cross-references at the top, we've now adopted enough policies that policies down at the bottom that are cross-referenced can be removed because we're now moving towards the model policy. So that's some good news, but would welcome any questions about policy CF, School Building Administration. All right, then seeing none, the final policy for this evening is policy DJA, Purchasing Authority. This policy had previously just referenced policy 4.23, but we have another policy 3.20 titled Outside Consultants, which is two short sentences saying the school board can engage paid consultants when it's beneficial to the school division and procurements comply with the purchasing policy. So we do think that it makes sense to add that cross-reference to policy DJA, since that policy does reference contractual services required by the school division. Any questions about policy DJA, Purchasing Authority? All right, then those are the policies for first reading this evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ms. Minson. Okay, if I could have, we're at 10.05, if I could have a motion, please.
Chair, if I might for 1 second.
Oh, yes, please. Sorry, Mr. Reitinger.
Is there any reason not, because these are all essentially pro forma changes, just to waive first reading, proceed to second reading, and adopt them?
I appreciate you raising that. The reason I didn't do that this time is it would, the action by the board of adding cross-references to the policies removes current policies in existence. So if there were questions or issues about removing those policies, I wanted to allow time to answer any of those questions. So the board could decide to waive first reading of these policies now, but it wasn't, not knowing if the board would have questions or concerns, I wanted to present an opportunity to review them a second time.
Does anyone feel, yes?
I don't see a reason. I mean, I appreciate that, but given that the board had only one minor change and they are pro forma adjustments, it would save some time in a future meeting.
Okay, Mr. Reitinger, you're on. Could you make the motion, please?
Okay. Chair, I move that the school board waive first reading and move to second reading and adoption of policies EBCD, school closings, CBA, qualifications and duties for superintendent, CF, school building administration, and DJA, purchasing authority.
Thank you so much, Mr. Reitinger. May I have a second, please?
Point of order.
Oh, yes.
Doesn't the motion on CBA have to be as amended?
That would be great if it could include that, yes.
Okay.
So amend the statement to say as amended. Thank you. Thank you, okay. Ms. Ortiz.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. Okay, could I have a second, please? Yes, Ms. Silverman, thank you. All those in favor say yes. Yes.
Yes.
All those opposed say no. Okay, thank you. Motion carries, and we will waive that. Okay, thank you, Mr. Reitinger, for saving us some time on a future meeting. And speaking of future, we're now at 11.01 future agenda items. Does anyone have any thoughts on future agenda items? Yes, Dr.
I would just say that I think you've added the school start time piece as a next agenda, future agenda
right,
item.
That's
so we'll
right.
make sure we capture that.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, Ms. Silverman.
I just want to say once again, I'm still interested in doing the early release Wednesday agenda item at some point.
Right. I think that is definitely on the docket. I think probably after, I'm assuming in the new year, probably not, you know, probably early 2023.
That's great. Thank you.
But it's definitely on the agenda.
Yeah. Anything else? Okay. We're going to move on to Section 12 now, Superintendent's Report.
Thank you. So a couple of updates. Pippin starts this week, and we're really excited. On Thursday through Saturday at 7:30 p.m. And if you're not able to come in person, there will be a streaming option on Sunday. At 8 p.m., so don't miss it. It promises to be great. I've had a chance to go see some of the rehearsals, and the music is just amazing, and the kids are just great. So go see Pippin. So professional development for our staff is obviously part of our big, is a big piece of our strategic plan with respect to investing in our people. And this week, we have had an opportunity to announce to many of our staff, and we'll announce fully on Friday, a tuition program that's going to cover two classes per semester at Northern Virginia Community College. And this is going to be a complement to programs that we already offer at the University of Virginia and Virginia Tech. We had, as for those of you that were at convocation, you know that I made an announcement that we were trying to grow some of our own teachers internally. And thanks to the hard work of Mary Beth Connolly and others, we've been able to build and establish a relationship at NOVA to create a pathway for anybody who wants to become a teacher. And it will be at our expense, but very inexpensive to do. And the students would then articulate on to George Mason University. The really great part about this program is that it is rigorous, but it also does give some credit for experience. So if you've been a paraprofessional in the classroom for a certain number of years, you're going to get some credit, and they're going to work through some of that as well. So we're really excited to kick that off today. Was the first day we started to talk about it, and again, we'll be announcing it to the full staff and faculty on Friday. It was kind of our soft opening.
Speaking of that, I think it would be great for the community to know it too. So, you know, when you feel like you and Mary Beth are ready to put it out there to the community, I think it just, you know, again, as much as we can remind people about our strategic plan and that here we are investing in our people, I think it's great.
Absolutely. This weekend, we'll be celebrating our beloved fifth grade teacher, Tori Fay, who sadly passed away. And on November 19th from 12 to 2 at the Mary Ellen Henderson Cafeteria, we will be there to share some memories for everyone who loved Tori. And there will also be a Be the Match bone marrow donor drive going on that day as well. So if you're interested in celebrating Ms. Fay and maybe being a donor, please don't hesitate to come. We invite as many people as possible to be there. Music, M-U-S-I-C, days are upon us, and MUSIC is an acronym that stands for Many Useful Students in Our Community. So hire a Meridian MUSIC student for your work, to work for you, and pay them by donating to the band trip to Nashville. Students babysit, they rake leaves, they pet sit, they'll even perform if you want them to. So if you have a need, and I can attest that my next door neighbor had some students come and rake their yard, and they got 8 bags of leaves out of it, and they made a nice donation for the students to go to Nashville. It's a great service that our students are performing. Just a recap quickly of last week, we had a couple of really great Veterans Day celebrations. We started at the community center, where we had an opportunity to celebrate Veterans Day, and then we went to Meridian's main gym, that was filled with middle and high school students for our Veterans Day celebration. And we also had alums and families of George Mason graduates. And there were four George Mason graduates that died serving our country in Vietnam that had not been fully recognized by our community, at least at the high school. So we had four plaques that were presented to Associate Principal Dave Sorensis, and they will be displayed in the school for future generations to learn more about these four men that died during Vietnam that were Meridian, then George Mason High School graduates. Oak Street Elementary made some really great cards for veterans that were delivered to the community center for the morning session and to the VFW event, so those could be shared as well. And when I got to the community center, it was really cute because there were these letters sitting on all the chairs for people, and it was really sweet. Students and teachers at Mount Daniel and Mary Ellen Henderson shared their family connections with veterans as well, and it was a great day overall. Yesterday was the return of career chats to Meridian High School. There were 30 professionals from a wide range of careers visiting our junior classes, and small groups met with these presenters, and there are three more dates coming up this semester. So if you all are interested in doing a career chat, or if anybody in our community is interested in a career chat, please respond to the emails when they come out. We'd love to have you. And look for the email from Regan Davis, and she did an incredible job organizing this career chat. In fact, we had the most people signed up to do the career chats ever, and it's a testament to her work. And then lastly, Jamestown trip. I know our own Ms. Silverman made her way to Jamestown and saw Jamestown for a second, and Vice Chair Gould was there as well. But it was really great to return to our in-person field trip to Jamestown and Yorktown for our fourth graders, and it was a special day for our students to learn about Virginia history. So thank you for going, and thank you for picking up, and thank you to our teachers for organizing. It was a great day. So that is it for me. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Noonan. Any questions or comments? Yes, Dr. Dimmick.
Thank you for your presentation. This is completely unrelated, so I apologize. So I picked up my son from the high school yesterday after his Pippin practice. It was like 6:30. It was super dark. That crosswalk is so dark. I don't know if there's anything we can do. So crossing Haycock after dark,
oh,
if any students are going to leave campus in the evening after the sun has set, that is a super dark crosswalk. And with the future closing of the sidewalk, I don't know if that pushes more pedestrians to that. I don't know what can be done. It just was, you know, at rush hour, there's a lot of traffic that moves through there at good speed. And there's, you know, there are no flashing lights. It's just dark.
Thank you for that feedback. There's a message board up Haycock that says, you know, new crosswalk in play, so be careful. But let us talk to our friends at Public Works and see if there's some way that they may be able to light that after dark for a while to help our kids cross, because that is true. Our high school is in service, you know, not 24 hours a day, but from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. at night. So we'll pass that on. Thank you.
I know Ms. Hardy has also said, I forget what the term is before it's, I forget there's a term for it, but where you can push the button and the starts flashing. I don't know if they have those temporary lights, but you know, do you know what I'm saying?
It's not a wink-o-matic, but let's see what we can find out, because there is one right now. I think what you're talking about is what's down by Broad and Washington. As you're going east on Broad, on the other side of Washington, there's a single street light that can turn red if needed and allow for crossing. So let's see what we can figure out.
Yeah, and actually, there are temporary ones down where I live at Lawton and Broad, where that big Whole Foods development's coming.
That's
up.
That's the one I'm referencing.
Oh, is that? I'm sorry. I was thinking you were thinking about the one at Clarendon's. Okay, but anyway, so you know, so there are. It
that's
does
exactly
seem that
the one
some,
I was thinking of.
Yeah, some temporary solutions there. I think that's a great point, Dr. Dimmick. Thank you very much.
Yeah, we'll work with our partners over in Public Works and see what we can
great.
Do.
Thank you so much. Any other comments or questions?
Okay, we're moving on to, thank you again, Dr. Noonan. We're moving on to section 13.01, board and student liaison comments. And do you mind, Ms. Tice, if I start with you?
Happy to. I don't have a whole lot to report. Rec and Parks did meet in October, and they are super busy. They were super busy with all of the fall events, with Halloween and the festival and all of that. So they had been very busy, but now it is quiet. They are moving right along with the Fellows property and the park plan that's going on there, and they'll be presenting at City Council, I think it's later in November, the 28th, I believe. So that will be happening soon, and they've got some really great, exciting plans for that small property, which is maybe of particular interest to the school's community since it's right across the street from Oak Street. The Health and Wellness Committee has not met since we've had our last meeting, though I know they will be particularly interested in our conversation, our school start times, and its relationship to sleep hygiene. So I'm sure they will all be either listening now or watching the link. And we are meeting again on Thursday. And then Speak had a bit of a hiccup and was supposed to meet last week, and it didn't get properly noted publicly. So we're still looking for a new date for that. That's all I've got.
Thank you, Ms. Tice. Vice Chair Gould.
Met with Chamber of Commerce, their monthly meeting. It was a great meeting about all the activity they're doing for supporting a lot of the restaurants and the community. I'll let you talk about the budget meeting that we attended, and then I can take the office hours that you and I attended.
We had
a great lunch, dinner together, and it was just by ourselves. So at Northside Social, which might be a good thing, but we're always... Yeah, we'll take it as good news, but we are meeting again in December at?
Quates Grill.
Quates Grill. So yeah,
actually
so
we'll November, post, November 29th.
November 29th. So we'll put that in the morning announcements. We'll run that in the newspaper as well, and we hope to have people come out and share their thoughts and their comments.
That's right. That's right. And we did, the board did have our signature on it, but we did send a letter out to the community explaining some of the reasoning behind our calendar policy CC. And so I just want to thank all of our colleagues, even though the vice chair's name and my name were on it. This was a team effort, and just thank you. You know, we overwhelmingly have had positive, of course, you know, a couple of people have had some negative feedback who I think, you know, disagree with the policy, but overwhelmingly the feedback's been very positive about that letter. And that was really just to help people understand where we were coming from with that. And so, you know, we'll see if the next office hours, if we have anyone come and talk with us some more about that policy. We are meeting in terms of budget. We'll be meeting with the City Council in a couple weeks to talk about guidance, our budget guidance. So that's coming down the pike. And I will, my couple quick updates are last night I attended the, as I mentioned before, the Education Foundation meeting. They gave out today, and I'm sorry, Dr. Noonan, did you talk about the super grants? Did I miss it? Okay, so I didn't think you did, but I wasn't sure. So today they gave out super grants to teachers, and they gave out $75,000 worth of super grants and then an additional $32,000 for advanced training. And this is phenomenal. Just to give you a comparison, Fairfax, I'm getting this, I don't know if I should say this, but Fairfax gave out $82,000. So you, just to give you an idea of like comparison, how much smaller we are, and we're right there with our big neighboring system there. So again, it's great. My understanding is too is that the Falls Church Education Foundation representatives like Debbie Hiscock and Mary Asel will also be working more hand in hand with Dr. Noonan and Mr. Bates about professional development. That was one thing that came up. And so just again to remind the public that, you know, when you do run for the schools or go to the gala, all those things are fundraisers for our grants. And so thank you to the Education Foundation. And you know, they can't fund everything. And so, you know, again, the more participation we get from community in these big events, the more money they'll have to give to our teachers. Today, Dr. Noonan and I and Ms. Michael and Mr. Bates, we attended the PEAK meeting with teachers, and it was a good discussion. This was our first meeting that we've had. We had a school-based leadership there. We had a representative from the secondary level as well as the elementary level. And I thought it was, you know, one of the questions that came up, just to give an example, was about the master schedule at MEH
and talking about which staff have access to that, and the school-based leader is going to go back and get back to us. So that's sort of what we were thinking when we had those people in the room, is that when school-based things come up, and those are things that ordinarily Dr. Noonan and central office staff wouldn't be privy to because these are school-based decisions, having school-based leadership in the room can help solve some of those questions. So I thought that was a good example. So we are doing this on a trial basis, and we'll meet again next month. I did talk to them. There was a question about the calendar policy and the federal holidays. And as you all remember, one of the things we talked about was one of the pieces of CC was talking about Dr. Noonan being able to use a federal holiday for teacher work day. And so they had some older language in, and so I gave them the updated language. If you'll remember, we sort of beefed that up. I think it was Dr. Dimmick's suggestion, so that, you know, Dr. Noonan does have that flexibility, but it's more of a last resort to use a federal holiday as a teacher work day. So they were good with that. And I think that was it for my updates. Dr. Ortiz, you have any updates?
Yeah, just a couple. The athletic boosters is meeting, or hopefully they're done, but they met today because last night was a winter athletics information night. I didn't get the update on that yet, so next month I'll have a complete rundown of all the activities from the athletic boosters. The ESOL advisor committee met a couple weeks ago. And among the things that happened is Dr. Santiago gave a really detailed presentation on all the services and how they're all structured. And then the committee, the advisory committee, took action to form a subcommittee to do a bit of a deeper dive on the assessment activities in order for that committee to get a lot of really good data to help them inform the charge with respect to executing the strategic plan. That's my update.
Thank you, Dr. Ortiz. Dr. Dimmick.
I wasn't able to attend the Choral Boosters meeting because it was the same night as the Gifted meeting, but the Choral Boosters are working on their poinsettia sale and preparing for their holiday events. The Gifted Education Advisory Committee is working on the Gifted plan. There are also some concerns among committee members about the moving the pullouts to every other week at Oak Street, so that is continuing. This morning I went to the Support Employees Advisory Committee. Dr. Noonan mentioned the professional development and courses at NOVA, and I'm sending a flyer around. Mary Beth Conley came to the meeting and discussed that, and that was well received. And then today, the library held their strategic planning retreat, and I went to part of that. I think it was a productive meeting for them. One of the things we can stay tuned. One of the things to give suggestions on at the meeting was how they could better partner with the school system. One thing that's come up at more than one of the library board meetings is around summer reading, and if we can better, if our schools can better partner with and communicate with the library on summer reading. They shared that it can be very, I guess, anxiety provoking for students and parents. The students come to the library with the list. The parents insist that the student must pick a book off the list. Maybe not believing the student that they can just pick an age-appropriate book. It doesn't have to be a book off the list, because sometimes the library doesn't have all the books off the list. But anyways, they would love to work with us on that more. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmick. Ms. Silverman.
I had a lot of meetings since the last board meeting. Dr. Noonan, you gave a great update on the Career Center at Meridian, so I won't touch upon that. However, there will be other opportunities in February, March, and April of next year for more Career Center meetings at Meridian High School. Additionally, and this is through the Business and Education Committee, sorry. Additionally, there was an in-person STEAM night at Oak Street, and it was Living the Dream in STEAM.
And it was, I think, the first time it's been in person in the past year. Maybe it was in person. I think this is possibly the first in-person one. Maybe it was in person last year, too. Sorry. And then also we discussed the MEH service projects that are going to be in the spring, where planning starts in February. I also attended a very long VSBA Zoom meeting where we voted on a lot of different initiatives to figure out what was going to be in our legislative package for the VSBA, not for Falls Church City specifically. Most of the things, I believe, were points that we agreed with, such as asking for funding for energy efficiencies, asking for funding for moving to electric or propane buses, many things that I believe this school district would be supporting. And finally, as discussed in the work session, Dr. Noonan, Chair Downs, and I met with Senator Sasla yesterday, and I met as the legislative liaison, and we just discussed different budgetary issues that he kind of envisions happening in Richmond over the next few months, and how he might be able to be helpful to us, and we might be able to be helpful to him. And that's about it.
Thank you, Ms. Silverman. I know it's been a busy couple weeks as we get close to the VSBA meeting and all that, so thank you for your work on that. Okay, we are at, Phil, do you have any updates? I did not mean to refer to you by your first name. Mr. Reidinger, do you have any updates?
Phil works fine for me. I attended the daycare advisory board meeting last night. As those who were remembering from the legislative package will remember, the daycare system is now subject to two licensure requirements, and so the one of the sets of licenses are up for renewal, and they're getting ready to go through that process probably into December, into the start of the new year. There was an extensive discussion about the, harkening back to our discussion earlier today around, elementary school students going home if there's no one to pick them up on the bus. What are the procedures to be used when when students are expected at daycare and don't show up at daycare for a number of different reasons? And I'm trying to make those as appropriate as possible. And then I also just wanted to share to the chair and vice chair that I also heard some very positive feedback on their letter at the meeting last night. So good job. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reidinger.
Can I have a quick?
Yes, please.
Just a quick go back. Two things I meant to mention. One is we had a really good SAO meeting today. And so I just want to thank the SAOs again for all of their support that they give to the schools. And Michael Kasher, our student representative, was attending the VSBA student rep portion today, and I think that's why he's not here tonight. So.
Great, thank you. Okay, we're at section 14, approval of minutes. I'd like to ask for unanimous consent to approve the minutes of December 6, 2021, and January 25, 2022, as presented. Hearing no objections, the minutes are approved. And we're at section 15, materials for board review. You'll see the monthly budget report and FCCPS enrollment for your review. And before we close out, any questions or comments? Okay, and I want to just thank the staff. This has been an extra long meeting today, but with two meetings in one. A lot of bang for your buck, but thank you all for being here. Ms. Goodell, thank you for ordering food for us. It was delicious. Just thank you again to everyone for spending a long, long evening with us. And to my colleagues, thank you all very much. And we are adjourned.
Thank you, Chair Downs.
Oh, yeah. I like your tie.
Well, thank you. My wife picked it up.
Right? Ooh.